Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the EAHC Podcast. This is episode number 5 or 6. I think it's 6. Oh, I should have checked that. Anyway, regardless, today we're going to be discussing a recent EAHC event, Battle of Five Armies, which was slightly modified due to various reasons. But Sam's here to help talk about that. And hey. because Dan's still sick note in bed, I've enjoyed talking to him last week. I've brought him back on. So say hello, guys.
Hey, hey.
Hi, yeah.
Right. So Battle of Five Army Books. Have we all played in it before?
I think I've played in every single one so far. I think that was the third one, wasn't it?
Yeah, I've definitely played in one or two. What about you, Dan? Have you played in it before?
Yeah, I think this is the only year I've missed. I think I've been to two. So it's been going 3 years, 4 years?
I think I can't remember, but it's a staple of the EAHC calendar anyway. Fortunately, I couldn't attend this year because I had to work, but that was a bit annoying, but I couldn't book it off because other people are on holiday. But Sam, you were there, you were helping run it because Sean also had other commitments this year. But how did do you want to talk to us about the event? How did it all go?
Yeah, sure. Because we had like so many dropouts like here and everywhere, like every time we filled the space, we seemed to lose another two people. We ended up with about 17 people. And originally, the idea was I was just going to drop out myself and we'll go blend some teams together to make it four teams of four.
Okay.
But spoke to Jack, and Jack volunteered in his good nature to drop out himself and then be at home as an on-call dropping.
Oh, okay.
Just in the off chance, there was someone who couldn't make it last minute. And so what we did was we blended Moria, Angmar and Fallen Realms all together. So we got men, three peoples, that team, and then Mordor. And then Sean quickly whipped up an alternative, matchups. So in round one, we're going to have men v the three peoples. Mm-hmm. Moria, Angmar, Fallen Realms. I'll just refer to them as the MAFR or something along those lines against Mordor. Round two is going to be men against MAFR and three peoples v Mordor. Mm-hmm. Round three was going to be men v Mordor and three peoples v MAFR.
Okay.
And then the final, what we're going to do is rank the teams based on how it's done in those three rounds. So the first and best, second best teams play off against each other, and third and fourth teams play off against each other with all these scores completely reset, and that ranks them as they are.
So it kind of went from the format of five teams, you play every one team once, and then the winner is decided by tournament points, VPs, etc., to a four-team event where you have almost a group stage, as it were, and then a knockout, which is, I think it's quite an interesting concept. It's something that I was looking at for an event next year, which I think you were part of the discussion of anyway.
Yeah, consider your prototype or something.
Yeah, I would definitely. It's a shame I couldn't be there because I'd like to have seen how that format works. Perhaps if you've got the spreadsheets, you could show me.
I've got a piece of paper which I was referring to as my tablet.
All right, cool. No problem. That works too. So the event. So the teams normally are obviously you would have your specific factions from their army book, and then you'd see various lists. Sean likes to have different lists from each book to represent the variety of lists that you can take within those books. Did you find that having such a big team, essentially having three books in one with the Fallen Realms and the Moria and Angmar book, did you find that there was a lot more different variety this year, or was it a little bit...
Saw loads of different armies in their ones. Camille, for example, he brought his Moria, we always see him bring that along. He seems to love that, doesn't he?
He's put a lot of time into it, though. You can understand why he likes to use it.
Yeah, he looks awesome.
Gorgeous army, yeah.
Steve Booth brought along a couple of armies, I believe. He had the Mummuk for one army. I used that in round one, and I can't remember if he used it second time. He used Uruk-hai at some point as well. So he brought that Uruk-hai, and he used Eastlings twice, I believe.
Oh, nice. So he brought three lists.
Yeah, much good. He was really getting into it.
Yeah, fair enough.
Kieran brought along a Mummuk army and, what was his second one? A Angmar army with Gulivar.
I quite liked Kieran's list with the Mummuk and Suladan. It's got a lot of nastiness in there.
Well, you know, Kieran, he's a good player and that, and literally all his games were over before I'd even blinked. Like, we was that thing, he just trampled the enemy army and that was that.
That is what I'm looking to do if it gets the opportunity. So
hasn't someone just won a tournament with that list? The Legion, anyway.
Chris Murphy?
Yeah, he's just won an 8-point GBHL tournament, which has really thrown a spanner in the people trying to work out what the meta is.
I definitely think that the meta is so new still, nearly a year on now, as we discussed last week, Dan, that you can literally take anything fluffy, and if you're a good enough player, it's got the potential to... Obviously, you have to consider what other things are in the meta and have a counter for them as well, but I genuinely think that any list is viable at the moment. And it's really nice to see a Mumak win a GBHL event, because I don't think it's ever happened before.
It's great. So. There's such, you know, huge, obviously, big set pieces, but they're so fluffy. It's what you want from the films. To have that actually be successful on a table is great in a tournament.
It's especially to put that many points into one big model as well.
I suppose it's partly because, like, there's just some things people are just so, like, you know, against using in, like, terms of, like, meta and that they just don't think to use it in this one.
Yeah, like, potentially. So what were some of the other lists, mate? Sorry, get back on track.
So if I go back to it, like, in men, I remember Ben had Numenor, like, one of his favourites, isn't it? Cameron, I'm afraid I can't for the life of me remember what he brought, which I don't think I've got to see any of his games in action. Oh. Actually, no. He might have had Rangers of Gondor, actually, something along those lines.
Okay.
Yeah, that sounds about right. I might be completely wrong, so on Cameron, if you listen. Jason, I lent Rohan to. I just got to see he had, like, I think it was Elfhelm, Theoden, Captain, Gamling the Banner, some Royal Guard and Riders, all mounted, nice and themey.
Nice, yeah.
And Charles Nurser, he had Minas Tirith with Boromir and Faramir, I believe.
Oh, nice. Boromir and Faramir at those points.
Yeah, Boromir and Faramir.
Which got... Fair enough.
I came up against him in round three. Chris had Dwarves, I believe, yeah. Yeah, Dwarves and, like, King's Champion there. I can't remember which hero he had, but, like, yeah. Aaron, he brought along Rivendell, as he seems to when I've seen him come along in the past. So he'd like the Twins, Curdon. Yeah,
he does like his Rivendell lists.
Tom Smith had Eagles.
I saw his Eagle Army. They were beautiful.
Oh, they were. You seem to be using them effectively as well.
Love an Eagle Army.
Yeah, you've used them this year, haven't you, Dan?
Yeah, really nice in the new rules. Yeah, lots of fun.
And James had Dwarves the time I played him. I can't remember if he had anything else there. I don't think so. I'm pretty sure he had just the Dwarves then. Now, Mordor, I have a bit more of an idea because they were my
team. You were team captain, weren't you?
That's the one. Will, I think, brought... No, he didn't bring a Blackgate thing, did he? No, he brought Gothmog's army. Tom Ramsden brought along like a mix of like a Shadow Lord. No, it wasn't Shadow Lord. That was Reese, wasn't it? He brought along. Christ, I'm trying to remember now. I think he had the Dark Marshal and the Witch King, something along those lines, along with Morgul Knights. And yeah, I think it's just those Morgul Knights. Reese came in like last minute pick, like idea.
Yeah, Reese was my replacement because I was a bit unsure whether I could actually play or not. And Reese had asked if he could have a spot, and I said, well, take mine just in case, and if I can come, I'll jump into a team because people were dropping out left, right and centre. But then I couldn't come anyway, but fortunately Reese could make it still. So
yeah, probably better than having to drop out last minute, isn't it?
Yeah.
Reese brought along... Yeah, that's right. Reese brought along Shadow Lord because originally I was going to have him, but because Reese wanted him, I wasn't particularly fussed. It was like, yeah, sure, I have him. I'll bring along Dwimmerlake, which was lent to me by James in the end.
That was quite handy that there's a couple of wraiths, because there's a question later on regarding ring wraiths and their viability. So that's handy that there's a bit more experience amongst us with using them.
Not in my hands.
No? All right. Well, I'll answer it then.
I've used a few. You're all
right. All right. Who had Sauron? Was it you and Will?
That's the thing. What I wanted to do is make sure we had him in every single round. So, we just took turns using him.
Okay.
So, round one, Will was going to use him. Round two, I was going to use him for the first time. Round three, Reese wanted to have a crack with him. And then round four, in the final, I was going to use him again.
Okay. Okay.
I can't say how he did in the other games, like besides the results, but it's got like when I've used him, he was just devastating. I'll do a quick summary of like how all the games went. And he basically like just destroyed the entire army alone.
Do you think, because we've discussed this before, I think, in a different podcast, me and Jack have discussed the viability of using Sauron. Now, this event is unique in that it's 555 points because it's the Battle of the Five Army Books normally. Obviously, it was modified this year. But do you think that at, say, 600 or 700 points, where you can pad out his list a bit better, he would actually be more viable?
Again, not in my hands.
Right.
went to unnumbered tiers, and we had good and evil armies. Yeah. So, like, for my good army, I took, like, Durin with Hearthguard and just a nice little mix of bits and pieces.
Okay.
And in my EVE army, I thought I'd try Sauron with Balduran and all that. And yeah, I did not use it well.
Well, that is a 100-point GBHL event, though, so it's quite competitive.
I did one of my classic moves. Like, I asked like a while ago when CJ was on, like, for your favourite facepalm moments. And I got one there where Sauron in Contest Champions killed Theoden, got the game nicely in the bag. It was all going swimmingly. And then he came against Eowyn and Merry and died. And which got
steamy.
Exactly, Dan, exactly.
Steamy. No, it's not steamy, but
then the next turn was got like it turned out I had just broken enough, like lost just enough to end the game there, because I was going to do a courage test with about 7 orcs, which got on courage 2, or get run down by Rohirrim and lose the game anyway by being tables.
I'm not completely familiar with Sauron, but doesn't he have the ring so he halves the fight values for every fight?
Oh, no, I don't think that affects it, does it?
I have got an Armies of Middle-earth book.
I don't know, he does. I'm
listen,
sure
guys, I'm trying. I've got a book today. Leave me alone. Let me have a look.
If that's true, I'll be quite upset. I should have been winning a lot more fights over the last few weeks.
I believe that is for other bearers of the One
other
Ring.
Bearers of the ring.
Is for Sauron himself. Right. The Lord of the Rings. Sauron can spend a single point of will each turn without reducing his own store.
No. Yeah, I'm probably just convoluting the two, I think.
I'm pretty sure it wasn't in his profile, so I wrote all the key points in that.
Oh, there you are. No, it's just the wound save on a 2+.
There you go.
He got unstoppable, where he swings his big club around. No, I think... The One Ring. Sauron does not follow the normal rules for the One Ring. Instead, once he wields the One Ring, whenever Sauron loses his last wound on a... or would be removed as a casualty, roll a d6 on a 2. So, yeah, instead of having what Frodo and Bilbo have, he has his own.
He has his own, yeah.
He has his own.
I prefer his rule, really. But...
I don't know. I think it works better for the other way. Obviously, for Bilbo, it definitely works better to run in and half someone's fight value.
Yeah, definitely, which was useful for that, which I was like using that couple, I think last year at the GT when I had my like Ravenhill army, I had Bilbo running in halving fight values while Thorin and Dwalin torn to pieces.
That's what I mean. He's very good at doing that. Anyway, so we had Sauron, you had was there a Witch King list?
A Witch King?
Yeah, in the Mordor lists.
I believe Tom had him. Yeah, I think Tom had him in there. It was originally, I was toying the idea of using him, but then Tom was quite keen, so he's like, you know what, I don't mind.
Did someone take a Blackgate Opens list?
Originally, you were going to, weren't you? I suggested to Reese that was open, but Reese had these like idea he wanted to use like his mix of like. Did I list Reese's army? I don't think I did. Did I?
Can I just ask? Sorry. Because I wasn't. I knew I wouldn't be going this year because of the whole knee broken thing.
Yeah, of course.
So I didn't really follow too much of the discussion. So last year was the last time we had the five army books that were being used, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So how did that translate to army building this year? So was it back to normal warband rules?
I think it was the same warband rules as like normal. That's
as
like,
normal.
Like no allies, etc. I think
was it still like tiered heroes and everything? So you still had tiered heroes?
Yeah, like Hero of Legend, Hero of Valor, etc. Like it was all same that way. Like it wasn't back to like the 12-man like warbands, regardless.
I was wondering because obviously I didn't know how it was going to be structured this year.
That's a good question, Dan. Actually, I didn't think about that.
Basically, like, we just like changed. I think no, we didn't change. We just took like the armies as they were in those army books and just like brought it up to date. Basically, like everything that was in those like translates across into the new like rules list. So, like, Fallen Realms, example, Uruk-hai is obviously gonna be in there. If there was something like it was a bit iffy, I think Sean like which got clarified that quite early on. If there was anything which is a bit of an in between army,
yeah, but you had so that had to be. From those, because I know a few profiles have perhaps moved around in the new.
Yeah, so for example, like Mirren and Dra, I'm pretty sure wouldn't have been inside like the which got Three Peoples army.
Yeah,
so they would have been in the Hobbit. So, Hobbit, yeah. Sorry.
Well, no, because Sean.
Actually, no, they're not the Hobbit now. Are they?
Yeah, Sean adds the Hobbit armies to their relevant books where he sees fit. So he would add, for example, like Iron Hills would go into the Three Peoples, and then. Gundabads would go into Moria and Angmar. That's what he done last year anyway.
Saying that, it occurs to me there wasn't any Hobbit armies at all in this, but I suppose that's because like people just didn't really think of it.
There was a lot of newer players there that I hadn't actually met before or events before. So perhaps they're newer players that have picked up the starter set like we discussed last week and expanded outwards from there.
Yeah. Which got like one of the newer players. I believe Charles hasn't been to any of our events before. Like, he seems quite capable. I mean, he won quite a few of his. Like, he came away with 3 wins and a draw in the end, so, you know, he's not terrible.
Oh, very good results.
Yeah.
So, the event itself, we've discussed lists and, we've discussed some of the lists that you can remember. Obviously, I don't expect you to remember 17 people's armies, and we've discussed the format of the event.
I'm not quite that good, mate.
No, and you've not been awake that long, so, to be fair. But how do you want to talk about how some of your games went? Like how your different lists? I know we discussed prior your results perhaps didn't go the way you wanted them to. But
as I say, I don't expect Tales of Glory, but you know, not for me anyway.
Okay, well, I mean, we'll quickly just go through some of your games if you want, and how your lists got on, and maybe what you would change next time around. Because that's the great thing about trying lists out is learning what works, what doesn't work, and how you can tweak a list to make it more effective next time.
Okay. We got my first game up against Richard Clammer, and in his army for this one, he had like a mix of spiders. Like, yeah, it was just spiders, I believe. Oh, and a bat swarm in there. So, like, okay. His only hero was the Spider Queen. He had like a mix of like giant spiders, mostly those, yeah, and then some Mirkwood spiders, like probably about 4 or 5 of them, and then the bat swarm dotted in.
It's quite a cool list, to be fair.
Yeah, which got, it was lovely and themey, which got, I mean, terrifying to behold, but, you know, it was Lords of Battle, so it was really like, not entirely certain if I can win this one, but I'll give it a crack. So which got, we put our team focus, which is another part of the event, like you choose a team focus on each of your teams, like as the captain, and the result for that is doubled for your team points. So like if you like a win, you get, instead of getting 2 points, you get 4. If you get a proper win, like with a difference of like 10 VPs or more, so like 10-0, 11-1, etc.
Yeah.
You get 3 VPs, double to 6. If you get a draw, then that's 1 double to 2. If you get lost, then that's 0 double to another 0.
Oh, well, yeah.
Yeah, actually. Fair enough. So I think I deployed first, and I just tried to deploy in a bit of choke points, and then remember the spiders can climb up walls and everything, so it wasn't going to help.
Certainly can, yep.
But I thought, you know, at least if I deploy right up against the wall, then they probably can't get into me because there's no space for them to camp down. Then I won priority. Sorry. Richard won priority, I believe.
Okay.
And he deployed about 7-8 inches away from me, you know, just out of reach for me, so I couldn't get to him. So he could try and.
Like, to you, I assume.
Yeah, so he could back off, try and get the charge, something along those lines.
Yep.
No, sorry, I had priority, that's right. I know, nearly a week ago, about 4 hours sleep, etc.
I know, mate. You're doing well.
And that's it. Dwimmerlake, like, launched himself in, compelled the Spider Queen forward.
Okay.
And then I threw my Black Guard captain on top of her.
Oh, I love that model.
Yeah, and Polder was like Black Guard, Orcs, etc. Just trying to, and made a no-fly zone around the captain, just to stop the Batsworn pulling him away.
Okay.
And Richard countered that by then charging all his spiders in as much as he could over walls, around my flanks, etc.
Yeah.
The bat swarm flew over my head and landed in the middle of my army and like attacked some orcs or something like that.
Okay.
I think he was like pulling spearmen away or something like that. And like next turn, that got stabbed to death and died or something. Oh no, it flew a little bit further in and got killed by, I think, Dwemlake charged in and knifed him.
Nice.
Yeah, Spider Queen, I think, managed to win that combat. But I obviously couldn't strike any blows because she's like been compelled.
Right.
I think she died like a turn or two later when I managed to transfix her again. This time he rolled like three highest, so always dies because I'd managed to drain away all his might trying to get him to stay alive.
Okay.
The Black Guard captain and all the orcs managed to stab her to death because of her low defense. And so like suddenly I've got a bit of might on the board and he's got none left.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got that edge. But unfortunately, Dwemlake doesn't have it himself. And that then as he starts spilling around the sides, I'm starting to get enveloped and start losing orcs here, there, everywhere.
Eventually,
he managed to just destroy enough of me, and I think I was probably about two spiders away from breaking him, and there was a couple of them on one wound. And he was like, ah! So, like, Richard ended up winning that one 6-2, because I killed his leader, and
right.
I hadn't quite broken him, and he got more kills and broken me, so it was 6-2 to him.
It's close though. A couple of wounds either way, you might have been in there.
What was quite a funny thing is like literally in about turn two or three in our game, like Kieran came and went, okay, I've won. And was like, wait, what? You've finished? I haven't had a chance to get up and take photos yet. Jesus.
I believe he was playing Mimak game on though, wasn't he?
Yeah, he literally just went forward, trampled. I got like my first Mimak query, and it was like at this point I realised I'm not the person to advise on Mimaks.
Right.
I have no idea what I'm doing with those things. It was something along the lines of, like, can you compel the Mimak? Like, got to turn around and trample your own guys. Or trample their own guys, rather. In the end, I think we ruled it similar to, like, how the Iron Hills Chariot is, like, with Richard's help, because I thought he might be a bit better qualified to answer on that one. And, yeah, we agreed on that one, that go by the Iron Hill Chariots, where they can turn around and trample their own guys with it. And, that resulted in, who was it? Tom killing Steve's army quite quickly and easily, like broken that way, I believe.
Yeah.
And then got 12 and a win out of it.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, which got after round one, like the team results were like men were on 11 against 2 for the Free Peoples, and Moria and Fallen Realms was 10-3 up against Mordor, because like we only got our one win with Tom, like everyone else, like wasn't exactly hammered, like we just lost.
Right.
In second game, which was Domination, I was up against James Wilson, and we've got so it's men v Moriang Mar, Fallen Realms, Free Peoples v Mordor. We've got James had his dwarf army, which I was expecting to come up against Durin because I've seen him use it before, but then it turns out he actually brought along Barlin, Floy, and a captain.
Oh, so he went for the Khazad Dûm list. No, he went for the
Moria reclaim
list,
so he's got Barlin the captain and Floy. It was Domination, so I had Sauron and a Troll Chief, which is my Sauron list, because last year I brought Troll. It works quite well because I can't be broken unless Sauron dies.
That's grim. Sauron and the Troll Chieftain.
Well, this year I had Might because there was an extra 50 points I could play with thanks to the change in that.
Right.
So I sat on the central objective and forced James to come to me and like try to fight me. And he sent a few rounds to take the other two objectives on the other side.
Yeah.
Sauron just did what Sauron does. Like in the first turn, he basically pummeled Barlin down to one wound, no fate, I believe.
Nice.
Barlin backed off, and the Troll Chief kind of picked up and ate him. then the captain caught up, and Sauron went through him as well quite easily. And he killed probably about eight dwarves in this time. Whilst the Troll Troop was just comfortable killing a few on the side on his own and then started going down towards one of the objectives.
Yeah.
Then I managed to get Sauron to do a barge around a pillar and get on Floy and kill him as well. So suddenly he's got no heroes left. And then it was just a matter of breaking him. And like once I sat Sauron on the central objective, I was covering quite a few of the other objectives with like his -1 courage.
Yeah.
as he starts doing his courage tests. So then we've got James is losing quite a few dwarves to the courage checks, because courage 3 is basically like normal men by that point. Unfortunately for me, we've got like he managed to keep one dwarf on each of the three objectives, and then my troll neutralized one in the other corner and Saradin neutralized the one in the center.
Yeah.
So he ended up winning 5-2. So it's quite a close result. I mean, last year I also played Domination with Saradin against Adam Pattenden.
Yeah.
And I only lost that one because, like, I think one knight stayed on objective and kept him that one. I was lost like 4-3 or something in that one. So I'm kind of never closer to win Domination with just Sauron, essentially.
I mean, it's a pretty difficult matchup to win with two models anyway. So, it sounds like you gave it a really good go, but the scenario just wasn't in your favour.
Well, James didn't really have a lot of choice in that one. He had to come face me, didn't he? So,
yeah, fair.
Yes, third round was Storm the Camp, where I was up against Charles Nursa, and I was back to my list of Cardouche, Dwemlake, and the Black Guard Captain.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So usually my tactics in this is, like, if I don't think I can go take the enemy camp, I'm just going to sit and defend mine.
Yep.
But I think James or someone else had, like, mentioned this, change that, not Charles, that Sean had made, where you expand the camp up to 18 inches.
Okay, that's a big camp.
Yeah, it was a big camp. So it was like, okay, well, I'm not going to be able to defend that with, like, you know, 35 models.
No.
So I'm going to go meet him. So the way this board was, it was that one where you've got, like, the two board halves with the, like, river across the middle, like, completing the board.
Yeah.
So, like, I just marched up to the centre and we end up clashing on the river. He sent some knights round to the side to try and go steal my camp at the last minute. So I sent the Dwemlake to go attack one because he was the only one within reach. And Dwemlake lost his horse and, yeah, struggling a little bit. He'd been, like, basically pestering poor Boromir throughout.
Right.
Like, you know, doing a little cheeky drain coach here, there and everywhere, like sapping will, etc. until he was down to none.
Yeah.
Then I managed to get back within range again and did a cheeky black dart and got a wound through all three fates on him.
Okay.
And then I think Boromir, several men had all piled onto one orc and somehow lost the combat. And then I did a cheeky wound on him again, just to add insult to injury. So suddenly Boromir's down on one wound, no fate.
Right.
Faramir's running out of might as well, I think, because they're calling throughout combats and trying to just get through my army. Because I think he's figured by this point he hasn't got any knights left, so he can't get in to go steal my camp. Because within the last 20 minutes, there's not enough time for turns. And at the same time, I was trying to break him to try and get even.
Yeah.
But then I realised, if I can finish off Boromir, he's broken me, but if I can get a cheeky wound on Boromir and kill him here, then I'm going to get a draw minimum. Because, like, I'm not going to let the Dwemlake get anywhere near him. I sacrificed Cardouche to get, like, and got 6 will back as well, which made life a little bit easier because he's not going to get a cheeky combat to just finish him off.
Yeah.
And then I managed to I think it was the very last turn. I grabbed 3 dice, did a black dart on Boromir.
Yeah.
Got the black dart off, and then strength and I hit against Boromir, needing 3 to wound, and I rolled 2, and I was like, ah!
Yeah, I've done that a few times. It's very annoying.
And like, oh, I've got my... Oh, wait, no, I don't have to do him, like, damn it!
Well, that's unfortunate.
Yeah. What can you do? So, Charles won that one 3-1, but again, not a terrible defeat, so I'm not having
so
to...
So, again, if you...
Nice and close.
Bit more luck your way, it could have been a completely different story again.
Say a bit of luck my way, but you know, I had quite a lot to get that one wound through all his fates and could to win that one combat to wound him again. So, I can't complain.
Swings and roundabouts, eh?
Yeah. I didn't mention last round's results, did I? Men against Moria and Fallen Realms was 6-7-2 Moria. And Free Peoples v Mordor was 10-0 to Free Peoples because a small mistake maybe by Mordor's light leadership. In Storm the Camp, which got Men v Mordor, Men came off 11-0. So we've got, I remember I was text chatting Sean to keep him updated on how the day was going after round 2.
Yeah.
And I told him the results, at which point it was like 17 points to Men and Moria, 12 points to the Free Peoples and 3 to Mordor. And he just went, who's Mordor's captain? Just sent a little GIF picture of like eye rolling, like,
You might have to retire next year, mate.
Yeah.
Well, which I've said, like, when he's doing this battle of the six or seven armies, like, event, which I'm going to go into, like, Hobbit Evil, because I think that's a little bit more suited to me. Which, you know, I think I'll leave before I'm pushed, like, pushed through. And Free People's Theme, Moria, Fallen Realms, was a 6-all draw. So the way it worked against the final was Men was on 28 points, Moria was on 23, Fallen Realms was on 18, and Mordor's on 3. So, surprisingly, Mordor's not in the, like, running for first.
That's an understatement.
Despite our best efforts, I still blame Will. So, we've got Men v. Moria, Fallen Realms, and Free Peoples v. Mordor. I was up against Aaron, who had his Rivendell list. It was one of the few times I was really, really happy up against an elf force because, you know, their fight ability 5 isn't going to count for much when I've got fight 7 troll and fight 9 dark lord.
Yep.
It was Fog of War, so unfortunately there wasn't a lot of secrecy involved with who I was going to have to defend, but at the same time, there's not a lot of secrecy who he's got to kill.
True.
So he started shooting me as soon as I approached because he was obviously not at the back. He was not going to play like it. He was like, as far forward as he can get, and he stood there and shot me a few times as I was approaching.
Yeah.
And then when I was within, I believe, about 9 inches of him, I compelled out a lone elf, pounced both Sauron and the troll chief on him.
Heroic combat.
Threw himself into their lines and killed loads of elves in the first turn of combat.
Nice.
Then he threw Eladan, I believe, at the troll chief. Right. And finished him off, basically. He lost, like, a couple of wounds through, like, as he marched up to the shooting.
Right.
And then there was obviously only Sauron left, and because of the, like, way I've built that list, I have to lose Sauron to be considered broken or 25% or anything, so, you know, I'm a horrible man like that. So he threw Eladan and Elrohirrim, and I was starting to lose might by this point, because I'm having to call, like, a strike, because I don't want to be, because I figured, like, he's got to get a 3 to match me, so that's not particularly likely. But then it goes down to 50-50 chance. If I call a strike, he matches me, and then he's got to win the roll-off, etc. And as we were fighting that combat, it suddenly dawned on me, if I kill one twin, the other one's going to be enraged and all the rules that come with that. So I like called my heroic strike, turned around, and I won the roll-off on a 2, which was, turn around, like, I pummeled Eladan to death, and then using the last 2 strikes, I could have hit the other twin, but I decided to kill 2 elves. Because then it occurred to me, that elf twin that was left over had 1 might. So he's forced to charge me and then call heroic challenge.
And yours is the higher strength.
So he's got to call heroic challenge, which means that no one else can get involved, and I've got 1-on-1 with him. On top of that, it means he can't strike against me. And It also means that when I kill him, I'm going to get D3 might back. So I've accepted his challenge.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's definitely a clever way to think about it. How did that work out?
I got 1 might back. I was a little bit annoyed, but you know, what can you do? By that point, so unfortunately, I had made a silly choice and I'd chosen Curdon as my target to kill. So I was barging elves aside, trying to get to him.
Yeah.
But, Curdon and realised it was going to be a deep shit and started making a run for it. I was like, when I could, I was trying to compel him back, but he had his resistance magic and his free will point, so that would be difficult. And he was using his free will point when he got priority to call Aura of Command and send the elves back in.
Right.
And towards the end of the game, suddenly I got this turn where I managed to barge and move 6 inches. Suddenly I was within range and I was like, oh.
Right.
And then I was thinking, he's got an elf who sat beside what's obviously his objective, because there's an elf stood beside a random staircase, you know. Yeah. I think the poker face is gone by this point. Do a cheeky chill soul on him if I can, and then I'll pounce on Curdon, and suddenly that's going to give me, I'm going to have broken him, killed my target. Yeah. I'm going to have definitely killed his defended guy, because all 3 heroes will be dead. And I was taking him off his objective. And then if I can, you know, have 1 more turn off that, I can pounce on my objective and then maybe make it 12-0 or something, you know, because I was the focus in this one, that could really help our team.
Right.
What actually happens is we ran out of time.
Oh, you couldn't get the turn off.
Nah, it's got Curd and stayed alive. So unfortunately, it ended up working out. It was Aaron 193 because he had killed the troll chief. He's got to defend. He was defending Curzon, because why wouldn't he?
Yeah.
And he captured his scene piece, and I got three because I broke him. Unfortunately, only Will won in Mordor. He won 7-5 against Chris. So it's got a nice tie game. He got the win, but unfortunately, the rest of us, like, we didn't lose terribly in our games. We only lost, like, by narrow margins. No one lost by more than four VPs. But actually, no, sorry. No, I'm looking at the wrong thing. I'm looking at our team score. No, we lost horribly. Yeah.
Will
won 7-5. James beat Reese 12-0. Tom beat Tom 12-0. And Aaron beat me 9-3. So, yeah. It wasn't as close as I thought it was. I was looking at the wrong bit.
Ouch.
The interesting part was in the first place playoff, though, because, like, obviously the way it works, like, you've got team focuses in that, and the team focuses are playing off, like MLB Cameron. And so for men, Jason lost against Kieran 6-9. Ben, who was on men, lost to Richard 9-3. Charles and Stephen Booth won. Drew 6-6. So that means that Moria and Fallen Realms are on two wins and a draw. So you think it's in the bag for them. But then Cameron pulled out of his arse, like, which got a 12-1 win. And because he's the focus, like, his 3 points got doubled to 6, and they actually ended up winning 7-5 to men. Talk about heroic acts now.
Oh, that's brilliant.
It's got, like, Sean was quite thrilled to hear that. It's got, so I'm thinking he's quite thrilled. We, like, changed it so there was a final round. It was all reset. It wasn't all in the bag from, like, you know, round three onwards.
Yeah, because you've had previous events before where it's kind of done before you...
Well, it's all, like, gone to Moria. It's all gone to Fallen Realms, men, etc. It's got, we know that Mordor's definitely coming last, you know. So it's got the rankings after that where, like, men came first. Moria got second with Fallen Realms. Three peoples came third and Mordor came last.
Yeah. Yep.
So good day, wasn't it?
So we've already discussed Sean's going to run the event a bit differently next year, and you're potentially not going to lead the Mordor team next year.
As I say, jumping before being pushed.
But again, we obviously do a lot of self promotion within our own events next year, and potentially, because of how the leagues work this year, and we are acquiring more terrain and scenery, etc. If there are more places next year, guys, please save the date, book it off well in advance, and let's not have as many people drop out next year, because hopefully we'll have a bigger and better event. And that's including myself. I'll have to make sure I book it off as well.
What I was saying to Sean is, like, it seems like July is just a very awkward time of year for people. Like, CJ loves this event and he couldn't make it because he was on holiday.
Yeah.
And also, as you've seen, we quite heavily rely on winning Mordor to win games for us.
I've got Eva this year. So.
I'm sure CJ will be happy to hear that.
He will. Which, like, his exact comment when he saw the scores was, Mordor, what the hell happened?
Didn't have New York in this year, so that makes
sense. Like last year, there was the Great British Team Championships that was in July and got cancelled because there was just not enough people for July.
I mean, so, July is the start of the holidays for a lot of people. And
yeah, this was
busier, aren't they? So
this was sense. Sean, I was suggesting maybe moving into April or doing, like, early September when there's a lot more people available to do this sort of thing.
Generally, the calendar this year has just been very full with. Trying to get our own events in has been difficult enough with the amount of GBHL League events, Southern League events, like, people were popping events up left, right and centre. So,
yeah, I was suggesting maybe just using July to just do, like, friendly scenarios day or something, you know, where it doesn't particularly matter how many people turn up. It's just more just play or do what you like.
Yeah, I've talked to Sean about this recently, that a lot of our events have been more... They've had a competitive nature to them. They're not, like, try-hard events, but they have got a competitive edge.
Whereas counts, basically.
Our first couple of EAHC meetings, like, all those years ago now, were literally just scenario days, and they were a lot of fun. So it's definitely something we're looking at to do more of next year.
Yeah, so, I remember I used one of these like fun 3 days, and that thing was back in February to kick off the Gondor War like campaign, and some trying to get through slowly, which got to, as we get models painted, people available and what.
Yeah.
Like I managed to get managed to get through like I think the first two scenarios of Osgiliath there, which were like one with Faramir, one with Boromir,
right,
and then did another one about 2 weeks later with James at Warhammer World while I was waiting for the GT, I believe, the fall of Osgiliath. Recently managed to get through another few with a mate called Will, like Will got through like the White Rider, Faramir Charge, and the Rider of the Rohirrim.
We've got a few more booked in though, haven't we?
Said we're going to do a few of them. Yeah, we just need to, you know, find the time to.
Yeah, of course.
I think they're good because not everyone has, you know, perhaps terrain appropriate for the scenarios.
Yeah.
Especially when it's like a themed campaigny sort of thing, like Gondor at War. So like, I've always been a big fan of sort of scenario days because, you know, people tend to bring in the right terrain. And it's all quite chilled out. People just play it to, you know,
definitely just a more fun, relaxed
sort of thing. Yeah.
There's no time limits. You can literally just play the game out until you're supposed to either win or lose, essentially.
Well, so people aren't going to make those like those moves where they think, I want to win this, I'm going to do X, Y, Z. This going to be like, you know what, this will be funny, let's try this.
But yeah, I'm just going to chuck whoever in because it'll be fun. Yeah, exactly, yeah.
You know what, Samwise is going to take on the Witch King. He's going to beat him. Oh, wait, Samwise is dead.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not sure about that one, but yeah. Okay, so the event went well, and congratulations, Kingdoms of Men. I think that's their first win.
I think Fallen Realms won the very first one. I think Free Peoples might have won last year, but, you know, I can't remember what I was saying like half an hour ago. So, you know,
it's the first year I'm not. Your first year I'm not playing for Kingdoms of Men as well. So, well done.
Says it all, mate. They took their flat tire off and they won the event.
That the anchor around them has been
replaced with Charles, who got 3 wins and a draw.
Oh wow, yeah, that's good. That's good.
Yeah, it's far better than me.
So, anything to add before we move on, mate?
Just if you see it come up next year and you want to come along, please do. Especially if we're going up to six, seven armies, then we're going to need.
Yeah, we're going to have to discuss the format of that.
Maybe like 30 people, if that's the case.
Yeah.
It's a really good event, and it's unique to EAHC because of it's Sean's brainchild in the main, and it's always been a fun tournament. And I was a bit gutted to miss it, as I'm sure you've been, Josh.
Yeah, I was.
And if it's been expanding next year, then it can only be a good thing.
You're also guaranteed not to be playing against the same army 3 times because, like the way it usually works, we had to change it a little bit this year. Like, you play against each of the other teams once at some point.
Yeah.
Oh, of course, yeah.
And usually it's, did you do it this year where you can only have one of the heroes for the armor book per
army? I think that's probably what's called Rider Ring, that one.
Like, riding one,
using the same thing, but honor really in this one. So, like, I was going to use Shadow Lord, and then Reese came to the team and said he quite fancied using that. And I thought I could, but I want to, you know, not keep a nice broad representation. Who haven't I used before? I've never used Dwarm Lake. Like, I'll borrow that off James then.
How did you, we'll just discuss this. How did you find the Dwarm Lake? Because in mine and Jack's, podcast recently discussing where I used the Shadow Lord for the first time and found that he was still really effective. How did you find the Dwemer Lake? Because I've never used him before and I kind of overlook him, but
the gnome might really, I really felt that because like after I built the army and like I'd like decided I'm going to use it, the draw was done and everything. So I'm like, oh wait, I've only got 3 mites in this army. This is going to be sore.
So it's Kardash and then 2 with the captain.
Yeah, literally, that was it. It didn't help this in Lords of Battle when I played against Richard and I killed the Spider Queen. I completely forgot I was supposed to regain a mic back for that. I could have really done with that.
Oh, no.
Never mind. Which could have been something, could have been nothing, who knows?
Yeah.
His magic casting is bloody good. He was getting off a lot of the spells I needed him to.
Yeah.
His special rule, I never actually used that. I think there was maybe one time I had a chance to, so I was quite low on will at the time. So I was like, I don't really want to be draining this away in case I get charged next turn.
Right.
Yeah, which, I mean, I think it was one of the games where I was really relying on Cardush's Fury to keep me in line. So I was like, I can't sacrifice him because otherwise I'm just going to lose the army if the Dwemlake just flees by some chance.
Fair enough. I mean, so would you perhaps use a different Wraith next year? Or you're not even going to play Mordor, but going forward with a Mordor list, would you potentially use a different Wraith? Or
I wouldn't say I wouldn't use him. I'd probably just like bring him maybe with Shagrat, for example. Shagrat's
so,
got,
so you've got a big killy hero, and then you've got the support from the magic cast. Yeah, that makes sense.
As I say, he's got like 3 might base, which got also like which got the fact Shagrat can regain might. So I've got, you know, decent supply coming in there because you know what Shagrat is like. If you start going low, you just go, I'm going to kill his captain then.
Yeah, I'm going to chuck him into something that can't strike against me and I'll kill it. Yeah, that's fair.
And if I'm particularly cruel, I might call a challenge against him.
I always forget the Dwemlake's in the Mordor list because I always think of him as an Angmar hero. Like, it tends to go along with, you know, the whole no might Angmar sort of lists.
Yeah.
And I just think his rules, what's it, six? It's only a 6-inch range now, isn't it, his rule?
And also, you've got to activate it with a point of will every time you want to.
That's it, yeah. Each,
every time, so like every fate point, every might point, every will point, etc.
You've got to be fairly close to the front line now. I mean, he's got a good casting. I'd like to give him a go in an Angmar list. I just they don't have the. You need like a might pack. You know, like a little hero with like a little might battery.
Like a little birder.
Yeah. Well, birder's a little bit too big to be a little birder. I don't think you'd call birder a little.
He's warm and cuddly. He's warm and cuddly.
I feel it's some favouritism here, Josh.
Birder. I'm a big fan of birder.
I'm a big fan of Bedard, really? But I just wouldn't call him warm and cuddly.
Great profile for his points.
I just wouldn't call him warm and cuddly. There's no cheap sort of mid-range heroes in an Angmar list, which is...
You've got captains.
Yeah, two might cap, well, I suppose. Right.
I mean, they're not great, but Angmar, so no, really, but if you're literally just wanting might caddies, then they're not overly expensive.
No, I suppose,
To get you moving and marching across the board. But anyway, we ramble on. Let's go into the Q&A section. I'm not going to do as many cheeky plugs this week because they just didn't work. So let's go into the Q&A section. I'll see how I feel about plugging some stuff at the end. Right, so our first two comments are from yourselves. One is suggesting a winky face and it's our first three-way. I'll leave that fuel to decide what Dan meant. And then Sam's put, and by answer... Because I said we'll try and answer the questions. Sounds good. We'll probably ramble off topic and miss the point entirely, pretty proud of that. Yeah. Anyway, so CJ's asked, it's relevant to him now. Now, normally me and CJ do discuss list building and we like to ask each other. I generally ask a lot of people. I send you a lot of lists as well, don't I, Dan?
Yeah, you do, yeah.
So he's put, relevant to me now. When you've got multiple list options for a tournament, how do you choose? So I'll start, if that's okay. Dan, you've not spoken very much. Why don't you start, bud?
Oh, go on then. It depends what you want to do. If you're looking to win the tournament, mm-hmm. I'd go with whatever. So my rule of thumb for list building, for if you want to be competitive, is go with the thing which has the most threats. So try and put yourself in your opponent's position and go with what's got the most things that they'd have to try and manage.
Yeah.
So whether that's big heroes or monsters or magic users, whatever will cause them the most headaches.
Yeah.
But if you're not going to, you know, win at all costs, go with what you enjoy. Yeah. Go with what you think will be, you know, I think the GBHL, you know, podcast say that the rule of cool. And go with what you think you'll enjoy most using. Sometimes that is the same thing. Sometimes you'll enjoy having different options.
Yeah,
being able to do different things and in different situations, but I tend to go with one of those two rules depending on what you want from a tournament.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
Yeah.
What about you, Sam?
Basically, like you take an army that you think could be really good. So like, look at the various synergies. Like, look at all the like rules all the heroes have got that could work well. Like with what I'm trying to do. Maybe mix in some terror, for example, which got magic. It's also like usually a must have. Sorry, I'm going to have coffee. Magic's usually a must have and all that. And then what happens is I look across the table and go, ooh, Bolg, that's mine. and then go, oh, this will be fun. And then suddenly, like, oh, that's gone out the window, and suddenly I've got a very uncompetitive course and I get my ass kicked.
Just realised asking Sam.
Yeah. Got, I mean, there's a reason I've collected a few wooden spoons recently.
I mean, no, that's fair enough. I mean, mine's a mixture of both, I think. Very much, if I'm going to compete, I'll look at the scenario pack. A lot of them seem to be random these days, which make it really difficult to build a list anyway.
I like that, though.
But if they are specific and I can tailor a little bit, I will try. But then if I'm not going to compete, so like the last event, my list had competitive elements to it, but it wasn't a competitive list in that it wasn't optimized. I spent a lot of points on models that really didn't do a lot for me considering the format. Arguably, I spent a lot of points on models that really helped considering the format. But, you know, I try and, if I can, I play test a couple of options. I didn't do that for the last one because I didn't have time.
Play test?
If you have got time and you've got someone who's willing to set up their army several times and either win a lot of games or lose a lot of games potentially, then playtesting is obviously a good option. If you haven't got time, just try and cover, as Dan said, just try and have usually three. I like to have three threats that they have to think about and deal with. And that gives you know what you want those models to do, etc. And then they've got to worry about what you're trying to do with those models. And it's kind of a mixture of both answers, really.
Gives you more flexibility as well.
Indeed. So if that helps, CJ, please let us know. Comment, please. Right. Next question is from Mr. Kieran Hatton, my young Padawan learner, who's probably surpassed me now, like Anakin. Anyway.
He's going to come back in like lock it off or something in a few years.
He's asked, at what points level does the game play best and why?
So we had a few different thoughts on this earlier, didn't we?
Yeah, so for me, having thought about it since earlier and the prevalence of big heroes, earlier I said 600, but I've thought about it. I actually think 700, especially as a prominent Mordor player, it means I can take a couple of really big things but still spam a lot of mid-pointed troops like my Morannans, which I love, or Black Numenoreans, but still have good numbers and big stuff. So yeah. I still have my three threats like we discussed, but I still have good numbers to try and win the scenarios because they are normally random. So for me, 700, if it's for a competitive tournament list building scenario, if it's like something different. So if, you know, me and Sean have played scenarios before where we've adapted the points to try and make the game a little bit more immersive. Like if we see the suggested army lists and we want to add something in because it makes sense fluff wise, then we'll tweak it a little bit. And, you know, we played a siege event where it recommended X amount of points for good and X amount of points for evil, and we just doubled it. And it was like a massive game and it was really good fun. So I would like
to see a siege event sometime. That would be pretty awesome.
It's just getting the scenery for it.
I know.
You've got to have like castles, maybe two
walls at some point. But
I mean, they're easy to build if you've got enough.
Well, I mean, I've got a Helm's Deep wall, like a fortress wall I could do. But
yeah, I mean, we could definitely talk about it, and it's something that I've wanted to do for ages, especially now.
One way you could do it, so I suppose, if you have a team of defenders of like maybe three, four defenders, and then eight attackers, and do it in like pairs attacking.
Yeah, I mean, that definitely is something we could do.
I think
there you go. Here's the rambling off topic thing again.
Indeed. Go on, Dan.
I was going to say, I think the problem with the siege events now at the moment is because I think they've slightly changed the rules with the new edition. So you've got more, you can't destroy walls.
Right.
I don't think in the new one from memory. Okay. They've gotten rid of the hit points for destroying walls. So you've got the siege weapons, but you don't have a lot of more options. You've got ladders.
You've got to go for walls or doors.
That'll be it. You'll have ladders.
I
think there's rules for siege towers, but I don't know the availability of the GBA of the Games Workshop ones anymore.
Right. I've seen a few on like eBay here and everywhere, but they always end up being bought by someone who's desperate for it.
Yeah, I mean, I know Sean's got a couple actually. So
I built one a few years ago, and then my mate knocked it over by accident. So, which got,
you know, potentially quite easy to build out of, like,
lollipop sticks and that.
Yeah, thin sheet wood or something. Anyway, we are rambling. your favourite points level, or your what you feel the game plays best at, Dan?
I mean, I think minimum would be 350. I can't see it being great much. If you play much lower, you may as well just play Battle Companies.
Which
is a great game in itself. I really love that. But to be honest, though, I think in the new era, I think it's gotten higher. So I would have the last, you know, version. It was probably about 600 to 800, and I think it's probably gotten bigger because you're taking bigger point heroes.
Yeah,
they're more viable. You're taking bigger monsters are more viable, even though things like Hurl has been nerfed somewhat. Like, I think you could happily take 1,000 points now.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
And have a good game.
I just think the only issue with a 1,000 point game, even,
is just the time. Yeah,
that's why I think 700 is, because you can play 700 in 2 and a bit hours.
Well, I think that's the other part of the question is whether or not you're playing it friendly or you're playing tournament.
He hasn't specified. He just said at what points level does the game play best at. So arguably, it doesn't matter how long the game takes, as long as it's balanced and you know.
Sure, I believe it's why like I view the TOs set like model limits in there, like tournament packs and that. So like minimum of 4 and then maximum of like let's say 70 models, for example.
Yeah, to speed the game up a bit.
Oh, 70.
Just so you don't get the old days where you had like hundreds of like Moria goblins, like bad captains or something.
Yeah, that was grim, grim. Is that 1,000 for you then, Dan? Was it?
I'd say for tournaments, still 600 to 800. But if you wanted to play, you know, if you've got the time,
if you and the mate are playing at home and you have all day to play a game, you'd want to play 1,000 points.
Absolutely, yeah.
All right, that's fair.
Big toys, lots of options, a lot of fun.
Sorry, mate, cut you off.
No, don't worry. Yeah.
And yourself, Sam?
As I was saying earlier, Scott, for me, it's a little bit of bias, like probably 750 plus, because like I like Azog's Legion, and like they've got a lot of very expensive stuff. When if you start bringing a lot of that, then suddenly you've got almost no troops. Like when I went to my first tournament, it was 1,000 points. Like Return to Rivenstead, like Sam Page and
Advent.
Like brilliant event if that ever comes up and everyone wants to go. But it's 1,000 points. I've never been to a tournament before, and I just thought, you know, I bought this Gundabad army, I'm going to just bring everything. So, like, I brought Azog mounted, Bolg mounted, 2 trolls, probably about 6 berserkers, something like that.
Yeah.
And suddenly, by the time I piled all that out, I had like 25 models, and like, I had no idea. I've never played a tournament before, so I didn't know if it was good, bad, or whatever. I was talking to Damien, in fact, before that. And, like, just because I was trying to get the SPG magazine off him and, like, ended up chatting to him, and he was saying, yeah, it's not a competitive army, but it'll be fun.
If it's the ideal scenario that you're playing the game at for a fun time, then, you know, it sounds a lot of fun. Like, you've got 2 massively good heroes. Trolls are always fun, even though they have had a bit of a nerf bat.
Yeah, unfortunately, it was in the days where they could just be immobilized and transfixed constantly.
Of course, yeah, fair enough. For you, 750 plus.
Yeah, it's got like it depends on the army you bring, though, doesn't it? Like if you like, for example, if you're doing like the Rangers Arnor, like Ben keeps saying, like he wants to like bring on Arnor, but like he just needs something at the right points level, because like once you start getting higher and higher, they've got not very many named heroes to work with.
That's true, and you're spamming captains and warriors to try and
everyone else is to bring in the likes of Aragorn, like Elendil, etc.
Yeah, that's fair. Okay, so Mr. Wilson has asked Aragorn, Legolas, and Gimli, shag, marry, kill.
I've got this one covered.
Right, go on then.
Right, Legolas shag, Legolas shag because he's the most ladylike. Gimli marry because we all love Gimli. Aragorn kill because I might become the king of Gondor. We can only find out if I kill him. Done.
I mean, it's an interesting concept. I took a slightly different when I thought about this question. Okay, so if we're assuming it's after the War of the Ring, James didn't specify, but I'm assuming it's after War of the Ring.
Because it is a deep question. You think about it.
They're all a bit busy during the War of the Ring.
They're all a little bit busy for those commitments. Yeah. And technically, Aragorn is already married. So I don't want to break. I'm not a home wrecker. So, like, you know.
So you just shag him.
I'll just shag Aragorn, right? One and done. Quick little thing. Happy days. You've then shagged the King of Gondor. You can put it on the.
You can put it in your resume.
Yeah, you know. And then marry Legolas because he looks the most feminine, which does mean I have to kill Gimli, which I'm quite upset about. But
it doesn't say you have to do it happily, so you know, I suppose it would work.
So yeah, kill Gimli. Right. I'm a bit upset about it, but that's my
Terrible, so you can at least like sit pretty on that.
Yeah.
I'd marry Aragorn.
Okay.
Because, I mean, he's a beautiful man, and just waking up to that every day, I mean...
I mean, maybe he'll let you join him with Arwen as well, you never know, but...
I mean, you know, fingers crossed.
Yeah.
Shag Gimli, I mean, you know, great. You grab hold of the beard and see what happens. And then I'd kill Legolas, because, I mean, you get bored of hearing, you know, Red Moon rises, all the goals are calling. All right, Leggy, calm it down. We've got other things to do.
A little bit more bloodlust than your answer, then.
Yeah, a little bit. So, yeah, you know.
I quite like the idea of you like going to shag Aragorn and then him just going, you look at my wife.
You look at my wife. All right, so thank you for that question, James. I hope you found that somewhat amusing. Ryan has asked, what do you think of the viability to say adding a Treebeard into a Rivendell list or something similar at tournament level? Now, we already discussed this beforehand. We actually did a little bit of research and a little bit of discussion beforehand to cut out some of the ums and ahs that tend to happen when we're thinking on the spot. And I think we are all in agreement where potentially Treebeard isn't the most viable because you lose his bonuses from being in a green...
He's being safe from being controlled by the enemy.
Yeah, so if it was in a green alliance, I definitely
Which they can't have, I believe, can they?
No, they're all
yellow.
I'm not checking books, I can't be bothered. But if there was a green alliance, then I definitely would take it. I think it's 100% more viable. If you're looking to add a big killy thing to a Rivendell list, I mean, it depends what you're already using, because for his points, you get Elrond with full gear, which I think is very, very good at the moment.
I mean, the Rivendell army bonus isn't necessarily required.
I mean, you could arguably, the Rivendell army bonus isn't necessarily beneficial. But if you already have, I don't know what his list is to start with, and I don't know what points level he's playing at. So,
I mean, for 190, you know, you'd add Gil-galad, big killy thing.
Or Elrond.
Yeah.
If you've already got those two, and it's a bigger event, and you're looking to add something else, I think we are all in agreement that potentially Gwar here is a better addition.
It might be that he's like me and he's just like, you know, got the Treebeard model, for example, and he's just trying to figure out a way to use it.
But he does say or something else similar. So,
okay, maybe not.
It's not that Treebeard isn't a viable option. I just think that because he loses his bonuses that I think are very important to Treebeard, Gwar here losing his +1 strength. Yeah, it's still not good, but he's still strength 6 and he's still...
And he's got monstrous charge, etc. So he can knock, like, Felbis. No, not Felbis. Does he have Herc strength?
Don't know. I'll have a look now. I've got a book. I will check it. Let's have a look. He has got, when I get to the
Michigan, defense and strike. I know that off the top of my head.
He's got strength, Gwar here.
Okay, so, you know, he's got
a knock up his strength to be able to knock Felwys flying, for example.
Yeah.
I think that's a tactic, anyway. I might be lying.
He's also 3-3-3 now and defense 8.
Yeah, he's very good now. Got here for 150 as well, so he's 40 points cheaper than Treebeard.
Yeah. He's got the fly special rule, so he's a bit more maneuverable. He causes terror. I mean, they're both very good, but it depending on what you're playing and if you want... I think Gwar here is the better option, but...
He's also moving a lot quicker for objective snatching.
Yeah, so like, you know, he can barge, you can, you know,
or like chasing down objectives, for example, like heirlooms, that's going to be particularly useful because like Treebeard trying to plow his way through, or Gwaihir just flies over the top and eats him.
Well, that's it. I was discussing this, I can't remember who with, but one of our recent tournaments, I think someone who was a Durin's Folk player. Mm-hmm. I think because Durin's Folk have a lot more limitations than Rivendell. Rivendell have got a lot going for them, especially in the current edition.
Yeah.
And Durin's Folk have only got the reroll ones as their army bonus, which I think's not great. And they're
useful when you're using Hearthguard and you're wounding on like fours a lot of the time.
It's pretty faint, it's pretty good.
I mean, it's okay, but I mean, you could live without it. And I think that's the sort of scenario where you might look at adding perhaps eagles in as convenient allies, because they'll then add, you know, a bit of maneuverability. You get the monster factor in to help, you know, deal with the line on line battles and all sorts.
Yeah,
so
no, definitely.
I think perhaps not Rivendell. I don't think, you know, it add much to a Rivendell list, and Rivendell probably won't add a lot to a Ent list, really. So
it's just bodies, I guess.
Yeah.
But the problem with bodies is that it just is like a nice easy way to break your big scary stuff. Like, when I've taken like Sauron to the Battle of Five Iron Books in the past, I made the mistake in the first year of like bringing like I think 6 Black Numenor and 6 Mordor Orcs,
right,
and was very promptly taught that was just like breaking meat.
Yeah.
He just ploughed through those, ignored Sauron, and suddenly I lost the game, and it was end over before I could do anything. Which is why I started swapping to the idea of bringing Mordor Troll, the Troll Chief, instead.
So, he is asked for at tournament level. So, I guess if it was at tournament level, I would look to add Gil-galad or Elrond first. If they're already in your list, and you want to add something around 150 to 200 points... I would say Gwaihir, then Treebeard. But the alternate to that, potentially, is having Radagast on Slay.
Yeah.
Because he's still a Yellow Alliance, and he doesn't bring you the monster, doesn't bring you the brutal power attacks.
Yeah.
But he does still bring you 3 might, 6 will with a staff, 3 fate.
Army at the minute seems to be like a mix of Elrond, Arwen, and Radagast, because I played it to the GT, and you spend a lot of time on the floor whilst he just kills you. It's very effective.
It's very, very viable, and I think for me, if you were to, the most competitive allies to that scenario would be pure elves with Arwen, Gil-galad, and Elrond, if possible, depending on the points. Then potentially it would be, if you were to ally something in, Radagast first, then Gwaihir, then Treebeard. But that's just me. I don't play the army that much. I have them, but I have never played them, really. So
you've also got great options in lists. You've still got Glorfindel, who's very good in the current option, in the current meta.
I mean, if you really want to keep your arm bonus, you've got Elendil, who is a beast.
That's true. You've also got the Elf Twins, actually, who I think are still very good at this level.
How many points is Elendil? Because that might be the winner
for me. 100, I believe.
180?
Armored Horse and Shield, I believe, is 200.
I mean, for me,
what Ben keeps saying when he's talking about his like, army list for us.
For me, if you're paying 190 for Treebeard, I just would take Elendil. He's a much better option. And you keep your green bonuses for both, so...
Yeah, exactly. That's just me.
Again, that's just thinking on the spot. So,
free hero combat return with Elendil.
Well, exactly. It's might efficiency. It's another big hero who's really hard to deal with.
Yeah, and the magic resistance from. Oh no, does he get magic resistance? Or
he's got unbending resolve, which is better.
Oh no, he keeps his alliance bonus in the scenario, doesn't he?
Yeah, because it's green. It's a green alliance.
Yeah.
So. All right. Well, I hope that helps, Ryan. Anyway, if not, you know, pop it in the comments.
If not, apologies for being completely irrelevant.
I think there's a lot of good discussion there. I think we actually answered the question quite well. So Jack's asked, keeping with the birthday theme, happy birthday, Josh. Thank you, Jack, because we were recording today.
We did say that, Tom, before you accused me of being heartless.
No, you said it earlier, mate. It's fine. He's asked, if you could choose any 3 hobby gifts for your birthday, one from past releases, one that's currently available, and one that has never been released, what would they be and why? Who would like to start?
I'm opening up the Games Workshop side at the minute, so.
I can go if you want.
Yeah, go on. Yeah. I'm still thinking.
I really want. I don't know if it's still available, but I've always wanted Bill the Pony.
Okay.
Just because okay, so that be from the that would be I the think, past release.
Probably past think. Releases. Yeah. Yep. I mean, he's not currently available.
I don't think he is.
No, I just love it. I just wanted to finish off Fellowship because he's for me he's you know part of it and he's, yep. he just no, looks yeah. quality.
Yeah.
I think currently available, probably the Mimic War Leader.
Yeah, it's a great kit.
I mean, it just looks fantastic. And
it's a great kit. And it's actually really good.
Yeah, it's really good. A lot of fun. And it just looks amazing. And then one that has never been released. Is that... Well, this thing, if it's a pre-existing model... Because there might be something to come out in future that I might want. So, you know, we've got references to like a Narian who hasn't come out yet.
Yeah.
But if there's one that, you know, that we've seen in books and things, the two-handed Uruk-hai scout with Axe who Boromir kills in the end of the Fellowship. Okay. But I'd really like Old Dane. I'd really like an Old Dane.
Oh, model. That would be cool.
Like, oh, I used to have one of those. I loved that one.
But not.
That was a thing, though, wasn't it?
It was, but then they've got rid of the profile, and I'm assuming they're going to. I'm hoping, not assuming, they're going to do an expansion, and then they model it on.
The current Billy, Dane model, but old. On. The,
exactly, yes. A Billy Connolly old.
Oh, okay. So yeah. it is something completely new in that regard. Yeah, no, that would be awesome.
Yeah, I'd love that. It'd be brilliant. I'd be all over that.
Okay. And for you, have you had a think, Sam?
I've got a couple of things so far.
Okay.
Like, in terms of something that's never been released, like, there is the two-handed Uruk Scout idea. Got another one I remember. Is I think there was, like, this one model. I think there was only produced, like, twice. I think there was one kept in Warhammer World, and there was one given to Peter Jackson. It was literally just Peter Jackson's A Hobbit.
Yeah.
Which got, that'd be quite a cool thing, just to, you know, just put on the sell page. Actually, now I've changed my mind. Keeping it.
Yeah, fair.
Five, nah.
Casual flex, you've got a one of three model.
Well, it's got, and well, you know, could actually, for your, that was could, for your could like, really break someone's heart, which could like put that in the put that in like a tournament prize and then just watch everyone like fight to the death for it
and then go, ah, oh, sorry, I'm keeping it.
Yeah, well, no, you get a picture of it too. Yeah,
you're a horrible man.
I know, okay. It's got currently available. Mm-hmm. It's quite tempting to just say smell, just because then you wouldn't have to pay for it.
Yeah.
You know, assuming this scenario, it. Give it to you.
it does say it's a gift. So, yeah.
But if you're offering, Jack, well, although, I suppose I have to get that to James. He keeps pestering me to get him a smell. It's got like, we made a bet a few weeks ago. It's got like, he decided the...
It's really a smell that it ended up being for a tenner.
When I told him that was not the agreement, he like still doubled what it originally was. one that's what was the other one? And past release, I know immediately what this one is because I'm bloody desperate to get hold of one. Which got Thranduil on Foot with Two Swords because I need its complete Mirkwood army.
Yes,
I've got to be elf, and the only like Thranduil I've got is in his pajamas holding his sword lazily by his side. It's like,
still a nice model, but. Yeah.
I know it is, but it just doesn't fit the profile I'm going for. I need the armoured version.
Yeah, that's fair. Maybe they'll bring it back soon, hopefully.
I'm hoping by Christmas time they'll probably be getting that back, but, you know, and we'll use it.
Hopefully with the, you know, the release of the, you know, multiple Gandalfs, the multiple Radagasts,
that
might eventually get around to giving a foot model to the Thranduil on Elk.
I'm hoping they won't do the same thing and put some on horse, elk, and foot as the pack that's already got the elk version.
I think that's what they'll do.
I hope they don't.
All right, so for me, I actually thought about this a little bit. So there's a... From the old Ringwraith on Nazgul on horses set, there was a Witch King where he's rearing up on his horse, and he's got his sword raised. So it's like...
Yeah, I know what you mean.
At the river, when the Arwen's like, cross and he pulls his sword and it's that pose. So I don't know if that originally came in the set of nine or if it was a standalone. Either way, if it came in the set, I'd have all nine happily. I think it's a really themey set, and it's definitely something that if they ever brought back out, I would 100% buy, or in this scenario, be gifted. From the current, I again would go with something that I probably wouldn't buy from a financial, like I couldn't justify spending that amount of money on one model. So I'd probably go for Smaug as well. Or I mean, I could happily spend the money on that's my dog going mental. Sorry, I could happily spend the money on Smaug. Yes. Yeah. So this Smaug or Dan's one of the War Leader, and of models that have not been released yet, I think anything from the Fourth Age. I don't know if we'll ever, if they're allowed to do that, or when the TV series comes out and we see potentially new again. If they're allowed to do that, I'm not sure. But anything after, you know, what we currently know as the strategy battle game era, that'd be quite cool. I don't know what they're if they'd be allowed to or not, but you know, I like seeing stuff. That's, I feel like a lot of the stuff currently is well covered, and yeah, we are missing a few like named people here and there, but generally you've got a really good basis of stuff. So anything that's new, essentially. So the next question,
when is there a gap in the calendar to organize another team events?
Jason tends to ask about events, and my answer is when there's a gap in the calendar and we can find someone to run it, I'm happy to let people do that. If you want to run an event, just run an event, put it up on the... There's no, like, hierarchy in the EAHC. Put an event up, people will either attend it or they won't. But, you know, if you don't organise it ever, then it's not going to happen. But if it's something that you want me to run specifically, or Jack, we can definitely do that next year.
I think the next gap in the calendar is probably August, but I think it would be the same problem as July, particularly with such short notice, organising that for people.
I think we're pretty solid for league events up until October, November. And
then but I can't imagine people will be available again because it's Christmas time, so it's more of like a friendly
time. I was going to see if we could do what we did a couple of years ago and have it early in December and then go out for like, have a big day. Last time we done Pennon or Fields. Like a big battle of Pennon Field. So something similar, but, you know, we all went out to the Carvery afterwards and just had a couple of beers and some food. So I was going to see if it's early enough in December, people might still, you know, be about, because people are still work up until a certain point.
Scott, there's also the problem Christmas parties as well, because, like, I've got mine in, I think, the 7th December.
Yeah, which, I mean, I appreciate not everyone will be there, but if there's enough interest, I'll happily do it. Tom Hawker has asked, he said, happy birthday to me. Thank you, Tom. Are you going to celebrate in Hobbit fashion, buy us all presents and drink and smoke pipe weed at the party tree?
Yeah, are you?
We've got a big tree at the heart. Maybe next time I see you all. So CJ's question, this made me laugh when he read it. Wrote it even. As you slowly get older and rue the inevitable passage of time, do you regret the percentage of your precious time on Earth that you spent playing with plastic soldiers that will last longer in the landfill they will eventually end up in than your bones, which will become dust, as if you to underline the futility of all human endeavour?
I'll tell you this
now, one. I thought about this. We can I'll all ask it, because I thought about it as well.
Okay. No.
No, because no. All cool. of my time yeah. spent playing toys has been with friends.
Yeah.
Or people that I've come to call friends. You don't always get the result you want, but I always generally have a fun time. If the game is still going when I have children, then I'm happily going to pass on my toys and my enjoyment of the game, and hopefully they'll pass it on and so forth. And we all, you know, go the way of the end part of your comment, but it is what it is. So, no, I wouldn't regret it anyway. That's the short answer.
I personally say yes, but not in the way that's implied. I'd say yes, but I'd rather have started playing like earlier, really, like in tournaments and that, because it's only like 2 years ago, roughly, I started playing tournaments and that. Until then, I was just playing like, literally a couple of friends who come around and borrow models. We just played amongst ourselves once every few months, really.
Right.
And that was literally the SPG I got to do, really.
So your regret is that you didn't start wasting your time sooner, essentially.
Yes.
It's a great answer.
Yeah,
it's like a great answer. And Dan, yours was a no as well, yeah?
Oh, strong no. Strong no. Yeah.
All right, fair enough. Right. So Mr. Sorry. Camp has asked.
Shut up, Dan, no barking. No.
No.
Ben Camp has asked, should or do you try and build a list to deal with one faction or the faction you struggle against the most, even if it means abandoning your main army?
I think basically what he means is like if you have one army you can never beat, for example, like Return of the King, should you abandon what you use the most to just simply so you can beat it?
Well, but I think the issue, I already looked at this question. Again, you can all have a go at answering it, but while mine's on the tip of my tongue, I think if it's for a specific event, you don't know for a fact you're going to play that army. So, you know, you're essentially building a list. You're essentially tailoring a list to deal with one army that you might not play. And then you're just going to come up against every other different army potentially, and then really struggle. I think you'd have a more negative experience.
Well, it's the approach I was going to say is like, it's got basically like, whatever you bring, there's always going to be some weakness you've got in your army.
Yeah.
Like, it's got, for example, Ed Ball, like, it's got all the Nature's Wrath and everything, but like, if he comes up with something that's like brilliant at resisting magic and also has a strong combat side to it and manages to get charge off him, like, and dismounts all his elves, suddenly he's got very expensive infantry and like wizards who aren't doing anything. So, like, you know.
Yeah, that's the great thing about this game. It's very balanced and there's hard counters to pretty much everything.
But, like, also, if you abandon your main army, you're abandoning what you know and what you can, like, what you can use inside out. Yeah. Got, you're trading for something you're not familiar with. And then you get, like, you might be able to beat that one thing, but then when you come against all the other things you use your hammer, you might be struggling. And then maybe that might upset you if that's what you're going for.
I think Ben's had a couple of bad games against certain lists and potentially abandoning all what he knows best and what's been working for him this year. He's doing very well in the league. I think he's fourth or third or fifth.
He's not far down, though.
No. I think potentially look at what you could add into your list, because I know that the Numenor gets +1 courage for, you know, if it's green, blah, blah, blah. But potentially you could keep your army bonus and add in something that counters things that you're struggling against. So where you might take Elendil and a Sildor, maybe drop a Sildor and take an Elrond or an Arwen, which gives you that...
Nature's Wrath.
The Nature's Wrath, which might help deal with the things that you're struggling to deal with. It might not, but I would never say...
Give you a turn of, like, free killing?
Yeah, I would never say completely just swap out your army to deal with one thing, because you may not ever play it.
I tend to, like, you know, swap here and there between armies constantly. It's not because I'm trying to deal with things, it's just because it's what I fancy playing, or it's just something new I've bought and I thought could be fun.
Yeah.
For example, like Ardacon, I've got, I think, three different armies to play in each event, like Chaos and Ard. I've got a mix of Minas Tirith and... which got fiefdom simply because I brought the clansmen of Lamadon. So yeah. I thought, I'll give that a crack. And I haven't used Faramir in forever, so I'm going to bring him along as well. And Knight of Light Tower, I don't think, he's ever seen the tournament, so why not? Yeah. Then when I'm playing doubles, I've played something a bit more serious because I'm playing with CJ and I don't want to be like more of the weight he's dragging along behind him.
Is this for your Strider Cup list?
Oh, no, this is Articon again.
Okay.
A doubles part of that, like, I think it's in the afternoon on like the first day.
Oh, okay.
And then in the singles, I thought it's going to be probably one of the most competitive tournaments in the year, so I'm going to bring something a bit more gaming than I probably usually would. So like Mordor and Easterlings paired up for like fight four black dragons. I don't particularly care if they all listen to this and plan against it, because what are the odds of coming up against them? Frontline and Rain Orcs of Strength 4 combined with the Witch King for his magic and his combat prowess, Amdur for his combat prowess and ability to kill heroes, and Kardush for Infinite Fury and Flame Burst.
You could arguably do that within the Mordor list, though.
So?
You could arguably add those things in within the Mordor list, though.
Yeah, as I say, it's just bringing along the Eastlings just to provide that 5 value 4, which got Pipeline.
Yeah, I mean, the fight four would be in the back rank rather than the front rank, but you could still have the fight four with Black Numenoreans or Black Guard or Mordor Uruk-hai.
True. It's also, like I say, just so like, I can then get two pikes on each person. So if I start surrounding a hero, then I can get absolutely loads in.
Yeah, that's true. But there are benefits to doing it that way, I guess.
Yeah.
Just to bring it back to the question,
the original question.
I think Ben sometimes, I think, brings maybe a negative element to his gameplay. I think it'd probably be fair to say, Ben. And he plays Numenor and Eastlings, and then I think perhaps bemoans the limitations of the lists.
Yeah.
But I don't think sometimes you quite, enjoy the strengths of the lists. No lists are perfect.
They've got really strong historical alliances that cover their...
That's it. I mean, enjoy the strengths of each list, and then perhaps look to thematically, fill in the gaps where you are finding you're lacking.
Struggling with Easterlings, but you could add a Mordor or
Serpent Guard.
Serpent Horde. I mean, they've definitely got some solid allies to both.
I think there's not. I think especially in the new era of the game. You shouldn't be playing the same armies each time and struggling, because I think there's just such a big variety of them, and I think the variety of players playing as well. I mean, armies do better at different scenarios. I mean, I lost to Ben's Easterlings recently with a Return of the King list, which is perhaps one of the better lists available in the game now.
I think it's probably arguably the most competitive now.
Yeah, and I lost to Ben because he had pike box with fight four, and I just couldn't win a combat.
Five turns pike line now with fight value five, thanks to Jimmerhill.
Yeah,
but this is the thing. I mean, they've all got. I perhaps didn't play the scenario correctly, and I was trying to get warmed up with the army. So I mean. I wouldn't say that you change your list to tailor to just take on whatever seems to be the mental block. Just try and think of creative ways to play it. If you know the limitations of your army, then you'll know the weakness of your army, and you'll just have to find better ways of countering it, whether it is adding allies or just changing your play style.
I definitely think the allies he has available to both of his main factions are...
He also has Angmar as well, which he plays a lot now. But Scott, I don't know when he last used that, but he's done pretty well with that. Like at war last year, I think he came 10th out of like 50 people with that.
Yeah, so again, you're not a bad player by any means. Just perhaps don't focus on that one army. Just work on well-roundness of your own list rather than trying to focus on how you beat one particular list, because a well-rounded list will do better overall than a tailored list to one specific army, in my opinion.
And just try not to get so negative about it if you are struggling.
Yeah, if you're having a... Because I've had it before where you've done everything you feel you can do and you just can't win the scenario, or you just can't kill what you're trying to kill.
Yeah.
And then your game just spirals because you're so frustrated with how it's going that you don't take a look at the overall picture of the game and see what you can do, which is something that I've learned from doing that in the past, is now I'll take a look at the whole game, and rather than focusing on one particular tiny part of the game, have a look at the whole game and see if you can move some stuff around, and try and play the objective, because obviously some scenarios are very different, and obviously if it's killy and you're not killing, then that's fair enough, but if it's domination or reconnoiter or hold ground or...
Yeah. Like I did against James, I tried to clear those two objectives and tried to scare off the others to try and win it that way. It just didn't quite work out.
Yeah, I think every army, especially the two main armies you play, have got some really good allies that potentially, rather than focusing on just completely scrapping them all and playing something just to beat something, I think working on well-roundedness of your lists will actually make the experience more fun. So I hope that helped anyway, Ben. Because we've been talking for a little while and we've still got a few questions
There's also Lost Alliance coming out sometime soon, probably around Christmas time for all we know. So there's always that.
We'll wait and see. I mean, the rumours are that's been put on hold, isn't it, because of the Amazon series. So we'll just wait. Yeah, so we'll wait and see what the next release is. They're working on it, wherever it is, I imagine.
So Sam Palmer has asked, what should you look at for when making... Oh, I'm going to reword this. What should you look at when list building for a good versus evil tournament versus making one that isn't a good versus evil tournament? So for me...
Well, I agree with CJ's comment for a start.
Yeah, so Fury from the Shaman.
It's kind of nullified when you've potentially got evil v evil, and there's going to be ring waves, so it can sap you all away.
Well, like, it is good versus evil, though, he has said. So.
No, I mean, you've got the potential for evil v evil. Like, it's got, then Shamans are a bit like less of a go-to, which got, when you've got good v evil, they haven't really got much they can do about it.
No, that's what CJ's already answered. Yeah. So, yeah, what he said, Shamans, if you've got access to fight four, because that's a lot of evil armies are fight three, so if you can maybe add some fight four units in there just to help you win a few more fights. But I was a big, I solidly just play Morannans. I didn't really mind about the fight value, but now that good armies have so many ways to get to higher fight, you've got Theoden when Rohan riders charge, you've got Boromir's banner, you've got Imrahil. There's probably more that I'm forgetting, but you know, I think having some units, some fight four. If you, I know you play Mordor, Sam. So if you're looking at a Mordor list, for instance, maybe try some Mordor Uruk-hai because they're still reasonably cheap, and I believe they're fight four.
They are, yeah. They're basically Uruk-hai, but like scout level, more or less.
Yeah, so maybe try some of them because they're the same points as a Morannon. But the only thing I think is the defense is one lower because they can have shields. Or some Black Numenoreans. I had a lot of fun with Black Numenoreans and a Wraith. I think that's a combination that I'll definitely look at in the future. But a Shaman, for me, some fight four and some way of stopping their big hero. So a caster of some description, whether that's the Mouth of Sauron or a Ring Wraith, normal Ring Wraith with some might, will, fate, etc., or one of the name ring wraiths with their stat lines as they are. That's my answer, anyway. Got anything to add to that?
You go first, Dan.
Oh, sorry, I was just gonna say, I'd agree with that broadly. Yeah, I mean, if it's good versus evil, good don't tend to have as many monsters unless it's a sort of all monster list. Yeah. So make use of that. And yeah, just make sure you tend to outnumber evil, tend to outnumber good as a sort of broad rule of thumb, I would say.
A bit cheaper, aren't they, generally?
Troops. Bar perhaps Lake Town, I would expect to have more evil models than good. So yeah, Shamans, just to make sure you're making the most out of the evil models, and they're sticking around or charging what you want them to. Getting your big point things in to stop their big point things. And I mean, I think you tend to have wraiths. I think wraiths are still good at almost any level of the game.
Mm-hmm.
And they tend to.
Well, especially when you can take a normal ring wraith for the amount of points they cost, give them their. You essentially get a captain with, I don't know, for instance, 282, and it's about 90 points. So it's not a huge investment, but it gives you what you need from.
It gives you that element of. Yeah, with Harbinger's a great rule. Combined it with, because not a lot of things on the evil side, on the good side, are auto pass courage tests. You've got bits of bodyguard, but
and an aura of command.
But again, compared to the amount of terror calls and things on the evil side, monster wise, and I think having that little bit of spell casting and a little bit of and the Harbinger rule, it just lets you, if it's good versus evil, it's hard to break down if you're a good player. They have to commit their bigger heroes to do more.
Yeah.
Which, again, whilst magic has been nerfed, there's still a lot of ways to deal with bigger heroes. Monsters. Dropping them in your list and things like that are always a big help. So
I mean, more or less, you drop a troll in, it's only 100 points, but it gives you fight seven and three attacks. So,
well, that's it. And I think also I've just said about ring wraiths, but I mean, if you look at Hobbit evil, you've got the Gundabad list where they've got no wraiths in, but you've got lots of cheap monsters with ogres. I mean, they're only fight five, but
yeah,
you've got fast moving monsters.
Mm-hmm.
That are, what are they 60 points now?
60 points. The Which trolls is, are 120. I suppose you can't say the stat lines, can we? But they're fairly decent. They're a little bit worse than cave trolls, basically. But they're faster.
But they're cheaper
and,
as well.
And you can get two of them for the price of a troll. I mean, if you have a few of them in your list, then you're going to be causing mayhem wherever you're going, really. So
yeah,
I think there's lots of different ways. I'd go mainly with monsters and spellcasters if you have them.
If that hasn't helped, Sam, and you want a little bit more of an answer, just feel free to message me, mate, and I'll go through it with you more in detail.
The only thing I could really contribute to that, because I don't really plan regardless, I suppose, maybe the Witch King be a bit more appealing, good v evil, just because Danakin's shattering stars of wizards and make them a lot less of a threat.
We've got to discuss race in a later question, but I completely agree that the Witch King is really good. Kieran Street has asked, what do you enjoy most about Lord of the Rings events compared to others you could go to? Do either of you two play other game systems where you've
been? No, I haven't played anything else at all. I just don't feel any appeal, really.
Okay, well, I'll take this as a solo question then, because I do play other events. I actually play... I've played 40K events, and I have played X-Wing events. Why do I prefer Lord of the Rings events? I generally think they're... Now, the X-Wing community, I don't know if anyone here plays X-Wing, but if they somehow listen to this, it's not generalizing you all. A lot of you are lovely. I've not had issues with, bar one or two people. I've never had an issue at an X-Wing event. But some people are a little bit more socially awkward because it's Star Wars and then it's X-Wing. And it's a very... it's a very precision-based game, and I'm quite a clumsy person. So, I try and limit the amount of clumsiness whilst playing X-Wing, but sometimes accidents happen. And a few people have got very upset with me because I've nudged a ship or, I've forgotten something that my pilot does, and then I've gone back to it, and they're like, well, yeah, you can't do that. So a little bit more game management from their players generally, even at a lower level. Obviously you get that in top table GBHO events, but for general Lord of the Rings events, they're not
quite often people just like, I meant to call her a strike. It's like, I thought you would.
Exactly. So for 40K events, I think generally they're, again, any 40K players, it's not all of you. I understand that some people do just play the game for fun, like I do for the most part. But I have been to a couple of tournaments, and you play the more meta competitive 40K player, and it's generally just not a fun time. So, because they have the disgusting combos that get FAQ'd a month later because they are disgusting and they need FAQing because they're broken and not balanced in any way, shape or form. But people who are trying to win at all costs will play them. And I just don't think you get as many. I understand some people play SBG competitively and they want to win all the time, but I think generally the player base is just a lot more friendly, relaxed, and a bit more relaxed and chilled out with it. And that's generally why I prefer SBG events to other events I have attended in the past.
Sure. I remember at the GBHL finale in 2017, I was playing against Lucas. I think you were watching this, actually.
Lucas Scottcroft.
Yeah, we played played in the penultimate game, drew, and played in the final game. This is basically the game for the one spoon.
Right.
And I remember I was playing Rohan against his Dwarves and Elves. This is an old edition before the arm bonuses and everything.
Yeah.
And I was basically staying about 7-8 inches away, just peppering with spears, until the last few turns.
Yeah.
Charged in, and I managed to get Theoden on his leader, I think was probably Barlin or someone of that caliber.
Yeah.
And basically, it was the combat to potentially win the game or lose it.
Yeah.
And I realized as we got to that combat, in the very last combat of the game, I'd forgotten to call strike. And it was you know what? Because it's not the world running up, but it could be something for one of us. So I'm not going to go back on that one. And luckily, I survived on one wound, no fame. It was I can leave my head held high here.
Yeah. I mean, but again, I'm sure if you said to Lucas at the same time,
I'm sure he would have turned around and said, which I can't blame you. I wouldn't have felt particularly good about that. I can't, reward my mistake.
Yeah, that's fair. So that hopefully answers your question, Kieran, if you hear this. Thomas Smith has asked, this question is really good, actually. Should the player, without priority, have to respond with at least one heroic action to the question, would you like to call anything, and be unable to call after, surely that's the privilege of priority.
Yeah, that's the rule as far as I'm aware.
Which I believe it's like if they say, do you want to call anything, they say no, and then you call something, they can respond, and you can keep responding back and forth until someone stops. Because there's always that potential they could say no, and then you say no, and they actually, I was kind of strike, but I was waiting for you to call something first, because like they want to get free or something. And it's like, well...
Yeah, but what he's asking is, should it be the etiquette that if you say... we come to the combat phase, me and you, Sam, and I say, any heroics, and you say no, should that then... I think that would be a bit
I suppose it would help with people against the Zog and Bolg. So I do agree that what's called like master battle full stop is a bit mean for the leader, but at the same time they do count on their combat prowess to basically carry them. That's their biggest strength. They don't have shoes and they don't have magic, etc. And they're not very good against magic. But I don't know, I would have maybe given maybe change it to a 3+ master battle, or maybe say it doesn't count for strikes, for example, just to give them some form of like weakness besides like waiting for them to roll badly. Because I know I've been on receiving end myself, which I can appreciate it, which at the same time it's a lot of fun when you're playing as it, but you know, it's one reason I don't use Zog very often, because like it's got, I know what's got some people just like, you know, deeply frown when they see that come on the table.
Go on, Dan.
I was going to say, I mean, the rule is in the book, it's the player who does not have priority must declare first.
Yeah.
That's the rule. I mean, I think it's a little bit cheeky to, I mean, part of the game, I think, is anticipating your opponent. Mm-hmm. And I get it, if you're playing a friendly game, then by all means, I think it's not hugely important either way.
Right.
But for tournament play, you do get the ability to reply, but I think you can't sort of continually do that or go on forever about it. I mean, when it comes to Master of Battle, I think that's a specific rule.
Yeah.
And it's specifically in... It has, you know, specific right to reply, but yep. I wouldn't say you'd definitely say no,
right?
But I'd say it is perhaps the polite way of doing it, or the correct etiquette.
What do you mean?
Yeah, I just think it's the correct etiquette, the way the rules are written.
Yeah. So to answer Tom's question, that's what the rules are anyway, right?
Yeah. Pretty much.
Okay, cool. Otherwise, because we're rambling now, we're on for a 2-hour.
No, and yeah.
So Jack's asked, "What's your least favorite army to play against? Can be most difficult or least enjoyable, and why?"
I don't really have anything I really, really, really hate playing against.
So for me, it's Iron Hills, 100%, because they have a blister that's incredibly good. Dane is incredibly good. The troops are incredibly good, and this might hurt a few Iron Hill players, having previously been one. I understand that there's some Iron Hill players who are incredibly good at the game, and they could win with other armies too. But I feel if you're not, I don't want to offend anyone, but I feel like they're a very forgiving army, and by just playing them, you improve. Because they're so forgiving, like the high defense, the high fight value, the high strength, good heroes. I mean, yeah, it's only Dane if you're playing pure Iron Hills, but I still think the captain on a goat with a war spear or their version of a lance is an incredibly good profile at fight 5.
Yeah.
The potential for master of battle on a 5+, you know, the strength 4 with a knockdown before you even fight potentially because you're on a goat. That for me is, like, fortunately, we don't have a lot of Iron Hills players regularly. I know yourself, Dan, and
as well, yeah,
Jack, and I know there's a few people who have them, but if generally that, or just dwarves in general, just hard to kill. It's annoying. But
you say that, but I feel like at, what was it, Sterling last year, like in my last game, I had Dane. Mm. It was, I think, to the death, and it was against like Mordor. And I think, yeah, I was quite close to them up in the middle. I called heroic move. Gothmog mimics with Master Battle. Gothmog got to go first. I didn't get my charge off. I called heroic combat. Gothmog mimicked. Gothmog got to go first. Gothmog charged into Dane.
Yeah.
Gothmog won the combat. Dane took three wounds from Gothmog, failed two fates, passed the last one, then a spearman just stabbed him, and Dane was dead.
I mean, that's a very particular set of circumstances that.
That's just me.
At the same time, you win the fight with Dane. Gothmog gets smacked because he gets wounded on fours. He's only got one fate, and you've killed him in one round of combat. So, it's opinionated. It's an opinionated answer. He asked what my least favourite to play against is, and it's probably some flavour of dwarfs, to be honest. So,
I can answer the most difficult ones, I think, which got, I think that's probably fiefdoms for me, because they've just got so many bonuses and synergies.
The synergy in the fiefdom list is very good.
A front line of Swan Knights backed by two like pikes on each guy with 585 across the board, so they can feint quite comfortably against even elves, which are like, and then they've got Imhil as a 6-inch banner.
And their defense across. 6 or 7, whatever they are.
6, I believe.
Yeah.
4 long granting the reroll ones to wound, I believe. What's his face? Aimbor giving fearless, and Dween here giving reroll ones to hit, I believe, with shooting on his guys. And also, what's got doing D3 wounds on monsters himself, which it's a nasty list.
Yeah, it definitely is.
But I think it's got, well, I think Fiefdoms has its sort of obvious flaws. I mean, it's very expensive. You're always going to outnumber them.
I'm not saying it's now, but
it's heavily hero reliant as well. So as soon as you overcommit with a hero, that's one of the bonuses gone.
Oh,
dog agrees.
Yeah, I think for me, I wouldn't say I have a least favorite army. There are different armies to play. I think there are least favorite. I think a lot of it comes down to individual profiles. Yep. So you're going on about Master of Battle. I think Master of Battle on the likes of Azog and Bolg is horrible.
Yeah.
And that's, for me, a little bit overkill for that list.
Okay.
And there's bits like that. But I think there's lists that I've had difficulty with, but I always find them, I wouldn't say I don't like playing them. I just think they're challenging lists in the hands of good players. So things like Rivendell in the current list, current meta.
Especially in the current meta, yeah.
I think Rivendell are really good, really difficult to play. And what was the other one? Gothmog's Legion. As someone who plays men, Gothmog's Legion is pretty horrible.
It's a very good list.
And Lake Town in general. I think Lake Town get, as we've spoken in the last pod.
Discussed last week,
They're very good for
everything.
Yeah, pretty much.
Shooting, they can do it. Fighting, they can do it. Good hero.
They really struggle with Lords of Battle, I suppose, don't they?
I mean, yeah, they do, but they also don't, because
not even that, not really, because I mean, you've still got a lot of killing.
Lobelia gives them +1 to wound. Yeah, on they the can charge. All, they most can of them can. Axes.
Yeah, most of them can pierce and strike, which like other Horde men armies like Gondor can't do.
I'm thinking they're like 5 value 2, and they're like defense 4/5, depending if they've got shields.
I mean, they can go down like.
Yeah,
Titanic, but at the same time, if they're winning fights, they're probably killing stuff.
I mean, you're taking them with Bard, so they're at least 5 value 3.
Yeah.
And all the heroes are up to fight 3 or 4 or higher. I mean, they're just, I'd say they're challenging lists rather than I hate playing them.
Yeah. That's fair.
That's the thing. I don't
hate playing anyone, but again, dwarves, they're just, for me, they're like,
except Tom.
Can't kill them. Except Tom. No, even Tom. Even just dwarfs. Tom Ramson has asked, which is your favourite name?
Not that Tom, different Tom.
And why? And who is better for area movement control, the Tainted or the Twimmerlake? So I actually thought about this question quite a lot. For me, in the old rules, it was definitely the Undying for obvious reasons. He just had 20 fate, essentially. And he's a very reliable caster. And Fel Beasts were a lot better, so the Undying on a Fel Beast was my go-to hero almost all of the time. In the current edition of the rules, I think it's the Witch King, obviously tooled up because he's really, really effective. He has the crown, which lets him reroll a dice for casting and resisting, as well as three attacks base. He can still take a fell beast. 1 second, someone's just knocking at my door. He can still take a fell beast, and that's my answer. I'll be right back.
Yeah, it's got like what was he saying? I was probably also say the Witch King for me. Like, it's got the same time. I don't know. I don't use Ringmaster very often. Like, it's got Dwemerlake, I suppose, is probably better than I probably gave him credit for this weekend, but I probably just didn't use him very well. Like, since the first time I ever touched him. giggity. Kamul, which got like me and Tom used last year at the Stockport doubles. And okay. Yeah, we used him miserably. We got him killed basically all the time. Because it's one of those ones we had to roll off to see who the commander is. We've like rolled in every single time. Kamul seized the reins and lost the game basically. Particularly when he lost us like contest champions, because he seized commander that, flew over the top, lost his fell beast to Madril, and spent the rest of the game lying in the mud, face down, being kicked by a Citadel guard.
I'd probably go with the Witch King. I mean, there's some good profiles for a lot of them. I mean, the Betrayer's great in the right list. But I think the Witch King, for just all round with the crown, he's fantastic.
He's very flexible.
And yeah, he'll do everything you want.
I think it's the utility from the Witch King is why he wins out for me.
Yeah, I mean, he's also got more of the strikes that a lot of them seem to be lacking now.
Well, he's got more might as well.
Yeah, and then for the second part of the question for. Tainted or Dwemerlake.
I'll come on to that as well in a minute, but I'll let you go first then.
Yeah, so for Tainted or Dwemerlake, Dwemerlake rules good, but you have to expend will for it now, and he has to be within 6 inches, and it's a 4+ roll. So there's a lot of ifs and buts in his rule.
Yeah.
I think the Tainted will give you better gameplay because he's got the 2 might. Similar sort of casting rules. And then presuming you're not broken and your enemy's broken, with his miasmic presence, is that the rule?
Something like that.
To stop, I mean, that can win the game for you.
Yeah.
At the right point.
Especially because it's Harbinger, so -1 courage.
Yeah, I mean,
another evil army, that's pretty much game over, I think.
I was going to say Dwemerlake, but then, remembering that rule, yeah, Tainted easily.
In the old rules, I would have gone Dwemerlake, but I think just at the right, that's it, miasmic presence, I think that's just fantastic.
Just as they break, it could be crucial.
So I actually looked at both their profiles before we started, because I wasn't overly familiar with the wording of both.
Yeah.
Now, they're both reactive spells. One of them you have to use, the Tainted one is almost in anticipation.
Yeah.
If it's early in the game and you anticipate a heroic move off where you're going to get charged, etc., I think it's almost invaluable. Now, if you spend one of your 14 will points and they don't call heroic, it's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
You know, like, they don't call it because you've spent a will point. Well, then good. You've achieved what essentially you would have done had they called it anyway. Because you're only going to call it if you know you've got priority. If they then don't call a heroic, you've essentially achieved what you would have done had they called it anyway.
Yeah.
As Dan and Sam just said, regarding when they're broken, it's an auto. I don't know why. Even if it kills you, it's probably worth it, in my opinion. If it's your last point of will, but it means they can't, or maybe a second to last point, because it's...
Suppose it depends on the situation. If you want to end the game, if it would break you by losing that one guy, if he'd be your leader, for example.
I think whereas Dwemerlake's one, is still very good. The only issue for me is he doesn't have any might. He does have more will, but he doesn't have any might. So
yeah,
you're relying on his rule benefiting you a lot more than the Tainted one. He can still do stuff because he's got 2 might. And I think the other thing is with the Dwemerlake's one, it's not an auto, whereas the Tainted one is. So you spend the point of will, and then
you might
have two, and you're like, oh, okay. Whereas you spend a point of will with the tainted. If they don't, then call heroic happy days. If they do, it's only the hero, because models within six they can't be affected. So for me, the tainted is the much better option. But
yeah, I mean, you'd, especially if he's on fell beast or a horse or something. You'd assume by then the lines are broken. You fly him into the middle of the enemy army, and then watch as all the warriors run away with that six. It'll be a 12-inch bubble essentially around him.
It's me, in which case they all stay and surround me and kill me.
Yeah.
What did you just try to do? Come here.
Okay. So, Tom, I hope that helps, mate.
Next question. James.
Mr. Richardson. Happy birthday for Wednesday. Thank you, mate. Wait there. Just for comedic effect, and I know it annoys Dan. Big shout out to James, friend of the channel. My mate. The club in particular, Jack, has done a brilliant job in putting money into maps and terrain this year.
Shout out for Jack, friend of the pod.
Co-host when he's around.
I didn't realise that board of scenery, which we were using at the weekend, was all made by him. Yeah, bloody good job, mate.
Yeah, he's done a great job. Hope you're having a good time on holiday, Jack, while we're shouting people out. We see a lot of villages, ruins, sort of generic Middle-earth scene boards or terrain pieces. James has asked, what would you like to see? His thoughts are Harrowtown, lots of terrain, camels, Isengard pits with cranes and wooden structures, Pass of the Dead, lots of skulls and dead things.
Now, there's
a big thread after this. I'm not going to go through it because most of it's about me and James putting together a Harad encampment, which is something that we're both now really looking forward to. But for me, I think a lot of Middle-earth does get neglected in terms of terrain board / scenery. I'd love to see some more stuff from the Eastern Kingdoms, that sort of area. I think you could get away with a lot, like, for instance, like the Corsair, Umbar is like a Numenorean city. I think you could get away with a lot of architecture. I mean, you'd have to be somewhat skilled to make it yourself, but I think if you know someone with a 3D printer and some level of knowledge of how to use it, then potentially you could get a really good, nice, like, not Osgiliath or not Minas Tirith city. I think, you know, you've got a little bit of artistic license there to sort of make it how you want. Yeah. But then also, you know, me and James discussed the Harad encampment with like an oasis and, you know, like a big tent for the leaders to sort of meet up and discuss things, and then like little tents around it, kind of like, I guess like a bit like Rohan in Return of the King, but not as
like an trying, evil,
yeah, not
evil
as like
done Harrow.
Evil done Harrow, yeah, kind of, yeah. With like a, you know, some big buildings. Me and James found some really cool stuff online yesterday. So for me, something that's just generally not seen as much.
What I remember CJ saying quite a while ago is he quotes the idea of a 3D board. Yeah. I think one of the best examples of that is probably in the SBG magazine when they did their Dol Guldur games.
Yeah.
I think it would be they used it as Seven Stones last year, and I was dying to have a game on it, but unfortunately we didn't get drawn on that table.
Yeah.
Just the idea. Obviously, if you've got like cavalry or monster army, it's not so viable. But like if you've got an infantry army and like fairly small numbers, let's say 350, 400 points, like fighting across the walkways and that sort of thing, trying to catch domination objectives, and that could be a lot of fun.
I actually got a chance to play that a couple of years ago at Seven Stones. So,
damn you.
I know we had a Erebor Dale Alliance versus a Goblin Town Warg thing. It was Billy Fitzgibbon had his bright green goblins out goblins, but it was a lot of fun. Having a 3D board is a lot of fun, and I think just because for this question I did actually have a look at, you know, the Battle Company's book. I know Josh, you haven't got it yet, because they give specific rules for like different like terrain.
Okay,
so like they tend to have like you know, haunted ruins, forests, but they've got things like Lake Town in there, but also Fallen Dwarf Hordes.
I think something like that would be really good, like a fallen, like, you know, it's got goblin and dwarf sort of holds where, you know, you've got, you know, bits of, you know, sheer cliffs on one edge and,
so,
you know, like collapsed ruins and buildings.
Moria, but not as built up, maybe.
Yeah, sort of something similar to that, I think. I mean, whenever we tend to play Moria, it tends to just be the, you know, the hyperstyle columned hall.
Yeah, that's what we've got.
But, yeah, but well, not knocking it, but I'm saying I think it'd be good to have more layers to that.
Yeah, no, definitely, I agree.
I think with more choke points and, you know, sheer cliffs and bridges and stuff like that, I think that'd be a little bit more. It's that's obviously awesome. Very difficult to do, which is why we don't see it. I think
the issue with having a 3D, I say issue, especially for tournament events, is that it creates
unfair advantage. Yeah.
Well, that, and it also creates extra. I don't want to say rules, like, can I move up here? You know, am I able to climb up this? Sorry, Sam.
Like queries, like
it adds extra elements of area of dispute is what I was probably trying to say.
Yeah,
where they don't necessarily need to be by just having a flat. Here's my pillars. Here's some rocks. Get on with it, kind of thing. But I understand. No, definitely, it would be cool to see something like that. I know we had the Goblin Town board that they had at Warfare a few years ago. That was really fun to play on. That was multi-leveled and it was awesome. Happy we covered that one.
Ramsden after that one, I believe. Yep. Yeah,
he's asked tips on playing smaller armies. Are low model count armies not necessarily all hero viable at tournaments, or do you need numbers in a competitive and strong army?
It depends on the points level, I think.
I think if you're looking at 600, one of the armies that is doing incredibly well at the moment is 13 models. Was it 14 models? Radiel on 12 riders. You know, that's what Ed's been playing a lot and having some success with. For me, I think a lot of it depends on player skill. That's no disrespect to Tom. I don't know. I've never played him. I don't know how good of a player or you know.
He got a 12-0 win by being, like, what's the word, clever with the Mummock and compelling it into all the other guys. So.
Okay, so, you know, I wasn't knocking him as a player. I was just suggesting that.
You leave my team alone, Josh.
I'm not bullying anyone, not calling anyone out. I'm just saying that potentially a lower model count army, so you probably got a more elite army. I think it relies on, A, your points of engagement, B, being really good at managing your resources within those models. So if you've only got two heroes with might, you've really got to, A, keep them alive and know when to chuck them in to kill stuff, and B, think about how and when you're calling certain heroics, because, again, you know, 600 points.
You someone... call that one heroic move, they counter with one of their, like, 9 might, for example. It's a lot less valuable to them if they lose it.
Exactly, and I just feel, for me especially, I mean, I don't pretend to be a good player of the game. For me, I know that having... numbers for me always makes me feel a little bit more safe about my heroes, because especially where I play a lot of strength 4 troops with my Morannans, is that, okay, you've killed my captain or my... I mean, I didn't really play a big hero in Shagrat before. Now I've got him in, I feel, you know, he's quite viable at doing what I want the Morannans to do, but better. But again, having a lot of strength 4, it only takes their hero to slip up and you go, right, now I've got all these dice to try and wound you.
Yeah, that was the weakness of Sauron. The minute he starts rolling badly and starts taking wounds, you start nail biting a little bit.
So I think for me, I prefer to have a couple of solid 100, 150 point. If I've got the Witch King, he's obviously more expensive because I want to put him on a Fel Beast and I want to give him all of his tools. I think the one I'm looking at is 220 points, maybe, which is a lot. But he does a lot for that army. He's a hero of legend, for instance, and et cetera, et cetera. So for me, are they viable? Yes, 100%. But you just have to really pick and choose when you engage and how your synergies within that smaller unit of models work. Well, so really know what you want to play and how you want it to work, essentially.
Well, like this weekend, for example, on like Saturday coming, I'm at the Tysers events, and it's, I think, 700 points. I'm using
five your models. Evil list is disgusting.
Big grin.
It's horrendous.
What's your evil list?
It's Witch King with Crown, not Morgul Blade, Crown, Armored Horse. I think it's like 3 Might, 3 Fate, and like 15 Will. Shadow Lord on Armored Horse, not an Armored Horse, on a normal horse. Amder on an Armored Horse, Gothmog on Wargrove Shield, and Suladon on Armored Horse. So basically, like, the synergy is going to be like Witch King's good for combat and magic, and also if I get Contest Champions, it's fairly reliable to get a decent amount of kills against what the limited amount they can get. Which the Shadow Lord's there to basically throw up his poor darkness and like to stop me losing my horses to shooting, followed by then just being a spellcaster at the back. Gothmog's there to mimic any heroics that get called for free. Suladon's there because he counts as a banner, and also he's given me a banner to everyone else within 6 inches, so it should cover the army. And yeah. Amphio's there because he's just good for killing shit. So we've got, as long as I manage that all right, could do a decent amount of damage, I reckon.
No, I mean, that's again, so that list on paper potentially goes through a lot of things fairly quickly.
As we were saying earlier, there's always weaknesses. I've come against an elf army in this 5v5. That's 3 of my heroes are going to be struggling. No, 4 of my heroes are going to be struggling quite a bit.
Yeah.
There's just to put my sort of take on it, I think if you don't want to go all hero, there's several armies that are already smaller numbers. So the Return the King list.
Yeah, I mean, that's the exception to what I said, because it's a really strong, solid list.
Well, I was going to go with that or Iron Hills. Iron Hills are always lower numbers, and
they're good.
Yeah, they're a little bit good, but again, I think it's a lot of things give a lot of, you know, Iron Hills also pass courage tests as long as Dane's alive and all that sort of thing. I think for most other lists, if it's going to be really low numbers, it'll be all hero.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's actually a really good, I don't know if anyone buys the SBG magazine, but there's a really good article in the new one about all hero lists.
Yeah, it's got read it. It was what's his face? Mikhail, didn't he?
Yeah. And
taken all hero list events before and done really well with it. So
he's got lists of like hit what he'd choose at 500 points, 750, and 1,000 for good. And some of them
he said evil wasn't done so much, but it could work. So
I think evil could work. Your list sounds horrific.
It could work. Like I say, it depends on what everyone else is bringing, how well I roll, how well I do.
I think you'll surprise people with that list.
There's always
if you take your time to pick, as I said, pick and choose where you, because potentially, you know, you charge in to put them all into a couple each, like two on ones. You've got six heroes, is it?
Five.
Okay, so
but Shadow Lord's not really going to get involved in the combats unless he has to, really.
But you could, you know, her first turn, heroic combat
could potentially kill somewhere around 15. Like,
yeah, you've 2 each, 4 of them heroic combat in. That's 16. Yeah, a good amount of model. That's horrendous, I think, potentially.
But it's like the
it works.
It's like of course.
It's like the theorized new Rohan all hero list, isn't it? With Theoden and just captains, yeah. So they're fight 5 on the charge.
Axe captains that are strength 5, strength 6 if they pierce him.
Yeah, just everyone heroic combat in first turn.
Which is free, why wouldn't you?
Yeah, call death.
It's grim.
It's absolutely horrible.
If someone worked out like 800 points, you get like Theoden gambling and like 7 or 8 captains. Could be more than that. That's just roughly off the top of my head.
Yeah.
So potentially you've killed like 30 odd models in it.
When I played Chaos Sonata, which got at Desolation, I was put up against the Yorkshire guys. So like it was world champion Connor and Matt.
Mm.
And I had my Marine army led by Gothmog, and I think I had Gurrits as well in there. And Will came up behind me, which got charged into me and then called death. And I didn't appreciate how bad that was going to be at first. And I lost half my army in the first turn.
It's like, grim.
Jesus.
It's grim.
Like, yeah, going back to that, if you've got low model counts, I think the best thing you can do is just limit the angles you can be attacked at, or like have something up to prevent them charging you, like terror or choke points, really.
Yeah, definitely.
Tom this weekend had Black Numenoreans. He had the terror up. The problem was he, at least in one of his games, got unlucky in that he drew Aaron, and Aaron had elves.
So,
so the courage doesn't really stop them too much. Even with the ring wraith, he's still courage of dwarves, and they pass the most part.
I mean, the flip side for that, when I played James 3 weeks ago, and I killed all his royal guard, and then his courage 3 men went down to courage 2 men. He just couldn't charge me, and I was like, "Oh, this is fun!" Just picking my fights, killing stuff,
reaching across the table, like pulling the tears off his face and drinking.
Yeah, he still won, but yeah. so the last question is Mr. Sam Palmer.
Hi, what's again, the lowest points you suggest playing at?
So for me, it's 350.
Yeah,
I wouldn't go any lower than 300, really. I think the smallest tournament I've seen was 350. It was another Rivenstead event, which I couldn't go to, unfortunately. It looked like it was going to be a lot of fun, because it was like... the rule was you could 350 points, but only one named hero.
Yeah.
So the synergies were quite limited. I think there's quite a lot of different choices there. I think Jake Tysto went in. He brought along just the Golden King with Harad and Fatties.
Yeah.
Who else was there? Yeah, George went along. I think he took something like Derbers and Cave Troll, all sorts of things.
Yeah.
I'm just going to fade memory what I saw as a list, really, because I wasn't there. Yeah. I really wish I could have gone for that.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to do a 350-point event next year, but everyone's been asking for more points, not less, but we'll see.
I wouldn't mind doing small point.
Started the escalation at 350, so
I enjoyed that game. The first game was quite tight because you got so few models. If you take a single casualty, you really feel it.
Yeah, definitely.
I was with Kieran, who's a good player as it is.
Yep.
And I had Durin and Hearthguard in preparation for the rounds to come, because obviously I've got to use Durin in that first round by the rules of the pack.
Yep.
And Kieran had Gothmog, because he was using Gothmog's army, so same idea. And on top of that, he had a drummer with him. So these Marines, when the heroic march, were moving 12 inches, and they were basically in my half of the board before I barely moved.
I remember walking around to your game, and it was turn 3, and he was on your board edge, and I was like, oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, I remember in that. I tried to pin him up against the wall and just tried to chop through him quickly with half guard, and it was working well for the most part, but unfortunately just managed to get away just quick enough. I was going to try and get Durin to pounce on Gothmog, get rid of him, and that probably could have turned it in my favour once the courage test came along. But luck was not quite with me on that.
Yeah, you were a bit unlucky there.
But anyway, getting back to the point, 350 points tournament, I think it'd be real fun, because you get five, maybe six games in that day. They're only going to need, an hour and a quarter each, aren't they?
Yeah, the last 350-point tournament I did was a few years ago now, but you got five games in a day, and they were, I think, hour and a half time, but most people finish within, an hour. So
yeah, hour and a quarter, I'm pretty sure, would be more than enough for that, because most people go have quite small armies, and that, 20 models, maybe even less.
Yeah, definitely.
And I'd say any smaller than that, you'd have to look at
battle companies.
And changing the board size as well, because 4x4...
Yeah, I think arguably a 4x4 for anything lower than 350 is just not really necessary.
No, it's far too big.
Yeah. And, unless you're playing Goblins and Lake Town, it's just not necessary.
CJ?
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to the 450 in September.
Yeah, I'm struggling for list building on that, but...
Was that in September?
The 450 league event.
Oh yeah, sure. Well, I've already vowed that I'm going to take Faramir, because someone's saying that they never see him, outside of his legendary legion. So
baited into that one, mate.
That's right. Well, it's going to have the more powerful armies. So I'm going to reward people who've got evil armies by bringing something not so horrible.
That's fair.
I'll bring something particularly fucking vicious for the evil.
Sorry for baiting you into that one, Sam.
Yeah, well, if I win again, then shame on everyone else.
That's very true.
particularly my life.
In the nicest possible way. I know people enjoy a long pod, but we've been nearly talking for 2.25 hours. So we'll wrap it up there. Guys, thank you for all the questions. Big thank you to Dan for coming on again. And big thank you to Sam for making his podcast debut.
In it.
Big thank you for all the questions and all the feedback from the recent pods we've been getting. It's something that I've really enjoyed doing, and hopefully it just gives you guys something to listen to and maybe some knowledge of the game. I don't know. I'll do the YouTubey thing. Didn't work last week, but I'll do the YouTubey thing. Please like video or pod. It's not necessarily, there's no picture to the video, but it is a video format. So please like the video, leave comments on YouTube, because it helps the algorithm apparently. And even if you don't watch it all because you get bored, just leave it on. It helps our watch time. It means more people see it. Just leave it on in the background. Do other stuff, but just leave it on.
And
do the like goal again. A bit upset because we've been averaging more than 8, but we only got 8 last week. I don't know if that's because people don't want to know what my secret project is and they don't really care, or just don't think we're going to get 20 likes, so they didn't bother. But we'll do 20 likes again, just for
me. Some people, it's like I watch when I'm on the PlayStation, what's known painting and that. And I don't think there is a way for me to like it, what's on PlayStation. So I have to like bring up on my phone and then click like. So it's just, you know, a bit more effort. But
just do it. All right?
I do it anyway, but you know, that might be part of it.
At least 40 of you that listen, just do it. All right, just like it for me, please. And that's it. We're going to go. 2 hours 15. I hope this has given you something to listen to whilst you're painting, etc. Big thank you to my co-host this week, and hopefully we'll come back next week with potentially Jack. I think he's back next week.
I
I'll catch you all later. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.